Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Lie Too Big to Fail, The Real History of the Assassination of Robert F. Kennedy, by Lisa Pease. Introduction by James D. Eugenio. Narrated by Donna Postel. I urge you to learn the harsh facts that lurk behind the mask of official illusion with which we have concealed our true circumstances, even from ourselves. Our country is in danger, not just from foreign enemies, but above all, from our own misguided policies and what they can do to the nation that Thomas Jefferson once told us was the last best hope of man. There is a contest on, not for the rule of America, but for the heart of America. Senator Robert F. Kennedy, Kansas State University, March 18, 1968. Preface. I am not old enough to remember the day President John F. Kennedy was shot in Dallas, but I remember seeing thousands of people waving at Robert Kennedy's funeral train as it passed through their towns. I remember thinking, even as a young child, that the best politician of my lifetime was already gone. As a child, that was a terribly depressing moment. As an adult, I've yet to shake that feeling. I learned to distrust the media while serving as Governor Jerry Brown's assistant during his presidential run in 1992. I would attend events and then see the way the media reported on them. Huge crowds were dismissed as a handful of supporters. The large protests at the Democratic Convention, where I walked the floor as a delegate, went unreported entirely. Liars were given time on Nightline, while truth-tellers were relegated to the alternative media. At the end of the campaign, I volunteered for a time with fairness and accuracy in reporting. Fair, because I was so incensed at how dishonestly the media reported on major events. I started paying attention to bylines, not just headlines. Who in the media could be trusted? Who could not? I started to wonder about other major events. If someone other than Oswald had killed President John F. Kennedy, would the media have told us? If someone other than Sirhan had shot Senator Robert Kennedy, would the media have covered that up? My first internet search ever, in the pre-World Wide Web days, was JFK assassination. I found an online group where the assassination of JFK was discussed in minute detail. I plunged headfirst into an argument there that lasted 5 years. I realized, right away, I was outgunned in terms of being able to cite data in defense of my positions. So I went to a local library and found a full set of the Warren Commission volumes of testimony and documents that accompanied the report. I started reviewing newspapers on microfilm, and even found some FBI files at the local library that related to the JFK case. I went from being a curious reader to an active researcher in short order. The more I learned about the JFK assassination, the more I wondered what happened to RFK. I read every book published on the case, including some obscure ones rarely cited. And then one day I opened the wrong drawer in the library and found, to my amazement, microfilm of the LAPD's and FBI's investigation into the RFK assassination. At the time, those files had only been released 4 years earlier. I knew only a handful of people, at best, had looked at those files. I realized I might find things in that data that no one else had found. And I did, as you'll soon see. Similarly, many witness interviews were never transcribed. I listened to hours of audio tapes, some recorded at extremely low volumes. I also went through a number of video archives throughout the Los Angeles area and found interesting nuggets that have never been reported before that dramatically contradict the official version of events. The official story is deceptively simple. A young Palestinian immigrant named Sirhan Bishara Sirhan shot Senator Robert Kennedy in front of numerous witnesses in a narrow serving area called the Pantry at the Ambassador Hotel just after midnight on June 5, 1968. Senator Kennedy had just won the Democratic presidential primary the night before in California and was walking through the pantry on his way to a room where the print media reporters were waiting. He never made it that far. 5 other people were wounded during the shooting. Sirhan was tried and convicted in a trial and sentenced to death. But even in the early days after the assassination, conspiracy theories were forming. Weren't there too many holes in the victims and the doorframes in the pantry to have come from a single gun? A bullet pictured in a newspaper was one bullet too many for the official scenario to work, as a housewife pointed out, to deafening media silence. Witnesses to evidence of conspiracy were told they could not speak to reporters per a judge's order. A film about a second gun that had entered the case raised numerous questions about the validity of the authorities' conclusions about the case. A criminalist from Pasadena with a lot of credibility wrote a report demonstrating that 2 different guns had been fired in the pantry, meaning Sirhan could not possibly have acted alone. Others pointed to the fact that witnesses uniformly put Sirhan in front of Kennedy, but Kennedy was shot from behind. The discrepancies in the case led to a formal re-examination of the evidence. A panel of experts examined the bullets to determine if more than one gun had been used. But the public was told of only a single key finding, that the panel found no evidence proving that a second gun had been used. They were not told other key data, such as the fact that the panel could not match any of the victim bullets to Sirhan's gun. And while the panel did discover one deliberate deception, they missed the much larger deception operation that had been pulled on them, as you will learn in this volume. It has often been said that one lie begets another. Nowhere is that more evident than in this case. Each time one lie was exposed, another lie had to be concocted to explain the previous lie away. Those who protected the lies ascended to higher positions of power. Those who challenged the official story would be shot at, sued, or marginalized as conspiracy theorists, a frame the CIA promoted to its media assets in 1967 when New Orleans District Attorney Jim Garrison was investigating suspects in the JFK assassination case with deep connections to the CIA. It really is a crime to marginalize the few who have spent years trying to find the truth about this and other cases, who have given generously of their time and resources, who view such research not as a hobby or a gruesome pastime, but as an important part of participating in what's left of our democracy. Each person bears a responsibility to pass an accurate understanding of the past to future generations, so that the country and humanity can successfully advance. When we turn our backs on the truth, either through lies or indifference, we are ruining our own future. Without an accurate understanding of where we've been, we can't understand where we are or where we're going. "Who controls the past controls the future," Eric Blair wrote under his pseudonym of George Orwell, in his book 1984. No one understood that better than Blair, who was himself an intelligence agent. He originally named his book 1948 because he saw so clearly where the dictatorial impulse led and how perpetual war for perpetual peace was not just an idea, but already in motion after World War II ended. The Cold War was a blanket term for what was, in effect, a series of resource wars Who would control the oil supplies around the globe? Who would control the rare earth minerals that made flight, computers, and cell phones possible? We will perhaps always be involved in resource wars, unless we recognize that nearly every international conflict is about resources, and that ideology is simply the fig leaf used to hide that fact. Both JFK and RFK understood this. Both actively sought to stop the plundering of the poorer nations by the rich. In doing so, the Kennedys put themselves at odds with powerful people who drove the economy, controlled the media, and ran covert operations. Both brothers paid a high price for their efforts to make the world a better, fairer place. I didn't plan to write a book when I started on this journey. I just had an intense personal curiosity. I wanted to understand what happened for myself. But as the years went by, and I read the books of others on the case, the gap between what I was learning and what appeared in print began to weigh on me. Reluctantly, I realized I had a responsibility to share what I had found. Thank you for being brave enough to open this volume. It takes a certain amount of courage to challenge the status quo, to dare to have a thought that differs from what the media screams at you daily. The media usually provides facts, but not always the clarifying context. Facts without context can become lies. "He robbed a bank" is a lot different from "he robbed a bank because his kid was being held hostage." While both statements could be technically accurate, the first statement is closer to a lie if the second statement is true. Context matters. After 25 years of research, I now believe I understand what happened at the Ambassador Hotel that night. I believe the truth about these events informs our current political situation. And I believe you have a part to play in this story as well. The truth can set us all free. Listen on. Then find me on Twitter, at Lisa Pease, and tell me what you think. Introduction by James D. Eugenio. The assassination of Robert Kennedy in Los Angeles on June 5, 1968, is perhaps the most ignored American historical milestone in the second half of the 20th century. In fact, virtually no historian recognizes it as such, which is odd, since it is clearly a marker in two ways. First, his murder climaxed a series of four major assassinations in less than 5 years. Preceding his assassination were those of his brother, President John Kennedy, Malcolm X, and RFK's friend and colleague, Martin Luther King. All four of these deaths were caused by gunfire and were redolent with suspicious circumstances. It was impossible to delineate the truth about the actual facts pertaining to them, since in each case, a cover-up ensued almost immediately afterwards. In an earlier book, Lisa Pease and I co-edited an anthology from Probe magazine called The Assassinations, which tried to demonstrate the commonalities between the four cases. The second way in which Senator Kennedy's death is a watershed relates to the outline before. His murder marked the end of an era. It was the premature death of the 60s. I do not mean that as pure numerology, but in the sense that in June of 1968, Robert Kennedy represented the last great desperate hope for the social and political activism of that remarkable decade. When he was killed, it was killed. Or as Jean Genet reportedly said, "America is gone." It is difficult to understand what that means unless one is old enough to have lived through the era. And fortunately, or unfortunately, I was. No feature film or documentary I know of has ever been able to encapsulate the energy, the idealism, The sense of empowerment that so many people felt from 1961 to 1968. And Robert Kennedy, from the beginning, was right there in the middle of it. RFK became the first attorney general to rigorously enforce the Supreme Court's Brown v. Board decision and the Civil Rights Acts of 1957 and 1960. He had planned on breaking the walls of discrimination by using those legal tools to file civil actions, showing that the states of the former Confederacy were circumventing federal law. To do so, he hired dozens of new lawyers in his civil rights department and almost a score of researchers to secure data proving his charges. The Attorney General filed almost twice as many civil cases in 12 months as his predecessor had in 8 years. This was such a drastic change from the Eisenhower-Nixon regime that it gave ballast to civil rights groups, and it inspired individuals to defy the status quo in the South. Why? Because they knew the Attorney General would do all he could to protect them. This was the case at the University of Mississippi with James Meredith, and at the University of Alabama with Vivian Malone. Robert Kennedy had Meredith escorted to and from class by two federal marshals during his student career at Ole Miss. Governor George Wallace brought in almost 900 state troopers to block Malone from entering his university. The Attorney General brought in General Creighton Abrams with 3,000 federal troops. After that nationally televised showdown, it was Robert Kennedy who encouraged his brother to go on network TV to give his epical civil rights address. As John Borer notes in his book, The Revolution of Robert Kennedy, the Attorney General understood that what he had done for the moral cause of civil rights had extracted a huge political price. He had lost the South for his brother's 1964 campaign. He therefore drafted a letter of resignation to remove the impact his legacy would have the following year. He did this on November 20th, 1963. Therefore, his brother did not have the opportunity to act on it. But such is the stuff of moral and political heroism. But it was not just on the domestic scene where RFK proved his mettle. After the CIA hoodwinked his brother into launching the Bay of Pigs invasion, President Kennedy put the Attorney General on the White House panel to find out what went wrong with Operation Zapata. The experienced lawyer found that, as his brother suspected, the CIA had deceived the president. They had lied to him about its possibility of success and then banked on JFK ordering in the Navy to avoid a humiliating defeat. When RFK confirmed this, with the advice of his father's friend Robert Lovett, the Attorney General recommended firing CIA Director Alan Dulles. But after listening to Lovett, the brothers went further and terminated the entire upper level of the agency. Dulles, Deputy Director Charles Cabell, and Director of Plans Richard Bissell. When is the last time something like that happened? Who was terminated over the catastrophe of 9/11? How accurate was Robert Kennedy about the Bay of Pigs? It's always nice for a prosecuting attorney to get a written confession. As scholar Lucian Vandenbroek later discovered in the Dulles archives at Princeton, Alan Dulles posthumously provided just that. In notes prepared for a magazine article, he admitted that such was his strategy. Knowing the operation had little chance of success, he wanted President Kennedy to commit American military forces into Cuba. In 1984, when Vandenbroek published an article in Diplomatic History on the subject, Bissell also confessed to this hidden agenda. As more than one author has noted, after this, Bobby Kennedy became one of the president's closest foreign policy advisors, going as far as serving as his back-channel emissary during the Berlin crisis in 1961, the Cuban Missile Crisis in 1962, and in the implementation of the withdrawal from Vietnam in 1963. Because of his position as first ambassador, RFK understood what his brother had been attempting to do after the missile crisis, which was to form a rapprochement with both Russia and Cuba. After his brother's death, RFK conveyed a message to the Soviets that JFK's plan for relaxing tensions would have to be placed on hold during President Johnson's administration. But he himself would soon resign, run for political office, and then the presidency, at which point it would be continued. For reasons minutely explicated in this audiobook, that did not occur. But the real point is this. When one adds to that his 9 years as a congressional chief counsel before he became attorney general, and his 3.5 years as a senator afterwards, was there a better post-World War II candidate for president than Robert Kennedy? And if there was not, what does his loss represent to this country? If the historians do not understand that loss, those around the event in 1968 certainly did. His funeral mass in New York was watched by over 100 million spectators via television. At that funeral, SDS leader Tom Hayden and Chicago Mayor Richard Daley both choked back tears. Jackie Kennedy had wept over his casket at a private wake, something she did not do over her husband's death. 2 million people lined the railroad tracks to bid their final farewells as his corpse was transported back to Washington to be buried near his brother at Arlington Cemetery. When it got there, hundreds of spectators from King's Last Crusade, the Poor People's March, came to pay their respects. As Arthur Schlesinger revealed in his biography of Robert Kennedy, it was the senator who had given King the idea to bring the poor to Washington in order to force Congress to act, which is one of the reasons King had decided to endorse RFK over Eugene McCarthy. Robert Kennedy was the buffer that kept people like Hayden and Daley from savaging each other. He was the inspiration that made students and peace activists believe the Vietnam War would now end, who made King think that once that occurred, he would finally get economic progress in addition to civil rights. It all came asunder at the Ambassador Hotel in June of 1968. We then saw the results in August in Chicago, where the Democratic Party unraveled and caused the election of the anti-RFK, Richard Nixon. Vietnam went on for 4 more years and expanded into Laos and Cambodia, the latter invasion provoking one of the worst genocides of the 20th century. Thus, the tragic arc of the decade was completed. It began with a Camelot period of hope and ambition. After 1963, it shifted into the angry 60s of Selma and massive anti-war demonstrations. After RFK, it dissipated into an escape into the drugs and rock music of Woodstock. But as Congressman Allard Lowenstein eloquently asked, why did so many intelligent people accept Sirhan as the lone killer of Robert Kennedy, to the point that they could not imagine the solution being anything else? Because the Robert Kennedy case became known as the open and shut case. After all, there were dozens of witnesses who saw Sirhan with a handgun firing at the senator from the front. Therefore, he had to have been guilty. And this is the pretext the LAPD and the district attorney's office used to snap on the cover-up for the public. But as this audiobook reveals, there was a lot to conceal to make the open and shut case appear credible. But what Lisa Pease shows, in even more careful detail, was the fact that Sirhan Sirhan did not get anywhere near the defense he was entitled to. Contrary to what people understand it to be, Sirhan's trial was not about the question of his culpability in the murders at the Ambassador Hotel the night of Bobby Kennedy's electoral victory in California. It was really about the state of mind of the defendant at the time of the shooting. As this audiobook shows, Sirhan resisted this angle of defense. So much so that he said in frustration He had planned the whole thing for 20 years, from before he would have entered kindergarten, had he been in America then. Sirhan never got a trial on his guilt or innocence in the RFK case. His defense team assumed he was guilty. In this, they were worse off than the prosecution. As the book shows, they at least understood the problems with the evidence. Sirhan's lawyers never explored those problems. As noted, the trial was really about Sirhan's state of mind at the time of the shooting. Therefore, psychologists were allowed to spend hours on end with the defendant. More than one person observed how easily Sirhan was hypnotized. All the psychologists who have examined Sirhan have noted how quickly and deeply he could be sent into a trance state, and also how resolutely he would deny he had been hypnotized once he snapped out of it. The few people who studied the case began to reread the novel by Richard Condon, published in 1959, The Manchurian Candidate. Having lived in Los Angeles for nearly four decades, I understand that during most of that interval, it has really been a one-newspaper town, dominated by the Los Angeles Times. One can measure the Times' honesty and credibility by what editor Shelby Coffey ordered his staff to do to the late Gary Webb's stories on the importation of crack cocaine into Los Angeles through dealer Ricky Ross. If you're not familiar with that episode, see the fine film Kill the Messenger. At the time of the RFK murder, the Times was owned by the Chandler family. All one needs to know about that fact is that Harry Chandler was the model for the John Huston character in the classic film Chinatown. The scheme depicted in the film, the funneling of water to the San Fernando Valley from the Owens Valley, actually occurred. Thus, the Times was instrumental in the defeat of Upton Sinclair in his race for governor in 1934, and they backed Richard Nixon from the start of his career. They had always been close to the LAPD, and they fell into line on the RFK case. But it was not just the Times. Ben Bradley and the Washington Post also did what they could to discredit those who thought something was wrong with the evidence in the case. Because of this media cover-up, most of the public does not know very much about the evidentiary problems in the case. This audiobook makes a quantum leap forward in both the explication of the crime and the cover-up. Lisa Pease has found new evidence that is too abundant to list here. Some of it no one even knew existed. Some of it surprised even someone as jaded as myself. On one key item, she called me up at night and told me to come down to the library she was at to see it. It was so exculpatory of Sirhan that she thought it would soon disappear, and if so, she needed someone to bear witness. I will not try to summarize the case presented here, but I will say this. If Sirhan ever got a new trial, this audiobook could be used to set him free. I doubt a prosecutor would even bring a case once he examined its contents. Former California Attorney General and now Senator Kamala Harris would have been humiliated in court, which explains why she resisted reopening the case. Lisa Pease has labored long and hard on the Robert Kennedy case. She has been researching in the archival documentation and calling witnesses for 25 years. She had to. When a cover-up is this systemic, it makes it hard to get at the truth. And it is a shame that a private citizen with limited resources had to take it upon herself to do so. As her book shows, the RFK case was never an open and shut case. In fact, the Robert Kennedy case is more clearly a conspiracy than the John Kennedy case. As some have said, one does not need to commit the perfect crime to escape detection. One only needs to control the cover-up, which includes the mainstream media, which disgracefully is all too eager to tag along. Ms. Pease demonstrates that paradigm in a way that no other author has before. As I noted, the murder of Robert Kennedy was a milestone in American history. This audiobook is a milestone in the literature on that case. Hope. This country is going to kill another Kennedy, and then we won't have a country. Driving through pre-dawn Los Angeles on June 4, 1968, veteran reporter Jack Newfield saw an inspiring sight. Large numbers of African Americans, Mexican Americans, and blue-collar workers were already in lines at polling places, waiting for their chance to vote for Senator Robert Kennedy in the Democratic presidential primary. By the end of the day, the turnout in Watts and East L.A. would surpass Beverly Hills, upending the long-standing political maxim that the poor don't count because the poor don't vote. Kennedy had forged this unusual coalition through what Newfield wrote was the best political platform he had ever heard. "It's class, not color," Kennedy had explained during his successful Indiana primary campaign a few weeks earlier. "What everyone wants is a job and some hope." Hope had been dealt a body blow during Kennedy's Indiana campaign. On April 4, 1968, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. had been assassinated on the balcony of the Lorraine Motel in Memphis by a sniper. King had been killed on the one-year anniversary of his first speech challenging the U.S. role in the war in Vietnam, a speech that changed his enemies from racists to the national security state. Despite pleas from his staff, fearing for his safety, to skip the Indianapolis event, Kennedy went to his prearranged rally, threw out his prepared speech, and delivered a hastily crafted one instead. As he informed the crowd of King's death, he pleaded for understanding, not hatred and violence. He reminded them his own brother had also been killed by a white man. And while ghettos all over the country burst into violent riots at the news, the ghettos of Indianapolis remained quiet that night. The following day, with violence across the country still echoing, Kennedy quoted President Lincoln, warning that, "Among free men, there can be no appeal from the ballot to the bullet, and those who take such appeal are sure to lose their cause and pay the costs." Years later, Newfield would describe how King's death became a turning point for Kennedy. Kennedy sought the presidency in 1968, he said, and believed, because of the war in Vietnam. But Dr. King's murder, preceded as it was by Johnson's abdication and the start of peace talks, enabled Kennedy to glimpse the deeper roots of America's internal disease and to imagine himself as the healer of that disease. Kennedy had, for several years, been tormented by the poverty and unhappiness of the other America. But it was only campaigning for the presidency, feeling the love for him among the poor, seeing his huge vote margins from slum districts, that showed Kennedy that his passion for the poor was reciprocated. This did not happen in one moment. It was perceived in action during the final weeks of Kennedy's life, as he spoke about poverty and racism, as he campaigned among the poor, and gradually came to comprehend how much he meant to them, and to understand that his career was no longer the private property of the Kennedy family, but that it also belonged to the dispossessed who cheered him with such hopes and voted for him in such numbers. Numbers were just what Kennedy needed today. He was still recovering from a defeat in Oregon the previous week. He'd lost, in part, due to a Drew Pearson column that ran the Friday before the election, which accused the senator of having bugged Martin Luther King. President Johnson had leaked the story, with Hoover's permission, to Pearson. The truth, however, was more complicated. Kennedy had approved the wiretapping of King because he wanted to prove to FBI Director J. Edgar Hoover that King was not the communist threat the Bureau believed him to be. Kennedy authorized, with King's knowledge, a wiretap on the phone line in King's office and home. What Kennedy never approved was the bugging of King's hotel rooms. Kennedy handled the issue poorly with the press, and Senator Eugene McCarthy seized on it immediately. The result? Kennedy lost in Oregon. Kennedy found the loss strangely freeing. Now no one could accuse him of riding on the coattails of his assassinated brother, President John F. Kennedy. He'd win or lose on his own merits. The morning of the primary, June 4, 1968, Robert Kennedy slept in. The day before, Kennedy had campaigned in Los Angeles, San Francisco, Long Beach, Watts, San Diego, and Los Angeles again. He had covered 1,200 miles in 12 hours before spending the night at the Malibu beachfront home of John Frankenheimer. The choice of Frankenheimer would prove ironic. Frankenheimer had directed the film The Manchurian Candidate, in which a U.S. soldier is captured in Manchuria, hypnotized by communists, and sent back to the U.S. to be used as a mind-controlled assassin. Before the next 24 hours were over, a consultant to that film would suggest on the radio that Robert Kennedy's assailant had been hypnotically programmed. Shortly before his death, that consultant would also claim to have been the assailant's hypnotist. Kennedy hadn't even wanted to run for president in 1968 initially. He had feared his candidacy might split the Democratic Party if he ran against President Lyndon Johnson, giving the race to the Republican nominee. But Senator McCarthy demonstrated that the fissure already existed by his strong showing in the New Hampshire primary. Kennedy wasn't certain McCarthy would be a strong enough candidate to compete against the presumed Republican nominee, former Vice President Richard Milhouse Nixon, in the fall election. So he considered throwing his hat in the ring. He was still undecided when his friend and John Kennedy's former speechwriter Richard Goodwin put on a recording of the recent Tony Award-winning musical Man of La Mancha. When the song The Impossible Dream came on, Kennedy shouted from another room, "Turn that damn thing off. If you keep playing it, I might run for president." Kennedy formally entered the race on March 16, 1968. 2 weeks later, President Johnson stunned the nation by saying he would neither seek nor accept the nomination. "Pick one out. They're all good dances," John Fahey said to a shapely girl in her late 20s who had come up beside him. The two stood looking at dresses in a store window in the lower lobby of the Ambassador Hotel, about 15 feet from a sign pointing up the stairs to the Kennedy reception to be held later. It was about 9:30 in the morning. The girl asked Fahey if he knew where the hotel's post office was. Fahey didn't even know the hotel had a post office, so the girl walked off. The Ambassador Hotel was like a city unto itself, containing a concourse of shops, bars, restaurants, the popular Coconut Grove nightclub, and yes, even a post office. But Fahey knew little about the hotel, except the location of the coffee shop, designed by celebrity architect Paul Williams. The hotel straddled two ground floor levels due to a small hill at the eastern and southernmost ends. You could enter at street level, walk up or down a staircase, and still exit at street level, as if you were in an Escher print. When Fahey had arrived at the hotel that morning, he had parked in the back lot on the southern side and hurried through the southeast entrance, as he was late for a breakfast meeting with a colleague. As he neared the entrance, two men caught Fahey's attention, because, although they looked Spanish, the foreign language they were speaking wasn't Spanish. From the upper lobby, Fahey had descended the spiral staircase to the lower lobby. He had been looking for his colleague when he had stopped in front of the store window and had his moment with the girl. Figuring he had missed his colleague, Fahey walked into the coffee shop, sat at the gracefully swooping counter, and ordered a cup of brew. A few minutes later, the woman joined him at the counter. Fahey asked her about herself. Her answers were surprisingly strange. She was from Virginia, she told him. But when he started questioning her about Virginia, she said she wasn't really from Virginia, but New York. When he asked about New York, she mentioned Iran, or Iraq, he wasn't sure later. She also mentioned Beirut, Cairo, Eilat, and Aqaba. The girl asked for Fahey's name, where he worked, what he did for a living. Fahey answered and asked what she was doing at the hotel. "I don't want to get you involved," she said.
"What do you mean you don't want to get me involved?" Fahey asked.
"If I tell you too much, they're liable to be watching me."
"Who?" Fahey asked.
"I don't know if I can trust you," she said.
Fahey noted she seemed very nervous, so they moved to the privacy of a table where they ordered breakfast. He asked for her name, and she gave him a few different ones, explaining,
"I can't go by my real name. I think we're being watched," she added.
Fahey looked around and saw what seemed to be the older of the two men he had passed on his way into the hotel, watching them from outside the coffee shop window.
"Is there something I can help you with?" Fahey asked the girl.
She told him she had to get to Australia to get away from certain people, and that she needed a passport. Fahey couldn't help with that. He had been in the service and hadn't needed one. He had no idea what you'd need to get one.
"Well, I know how to get a passport," she said,
surprising Fahey. She told him that she could get a deceased person's name, use that person's social security number, write to their place of birth, get the birth certificate, and get a passport made with that information. Fahey had initially assumed the girl was a troubled prostitute. Her comments, however, put things in a different light. His bigger surprise came with her next question. Could he come to the hotel tonight, to the winning reception, to watch them get Mr. Kennedy?
"What do you mean?" Fahey asked.
"Well, they're going to take care of Mr. Kennedy tonight."
At this, Fahey felt uncomfortable and wanted to leave. But being a gentleman, we were having breakfast, and I didn't want to cut it off or dump her. She told me that we were being watched, and I did see this guy watching us. He told her he had business up the coast. She invited herself along. Fahey started to pay for breakfast, but the girl beat him to it. She pulled out a wallet that had, to Fahey's surprise, a number of large bills, $50 and $100 bills. Still, Fahey felt strongly that a gentleman should pay, and he did. He started to lead her out, but she knew a different way, taking Fahey up a staircase he'd never seen before that led to the back parking lot. They got into Fahey's car and drove up the coast, past where Robert Kennedy was still sleeping. The marine layer locals call the June gloom hung over the coast like a shroud. It was late in the morning before Kennedy awoke. He phoned Dick Goodwin and invited him to come out to Malibu to join his party, which included 6 of his 10 children, his wife Ethel, then pregnant with their 11th child, Theodore White, and Fred Dutton. Despite the cloudy sky, Kennedy took his children to the beach. As the kids played, Kennedy and White discussed coastal pollution, the disappearing kelp beds, and which ocean was better, the Atlantic or the Pacific. Naturally, Kennedy preferred Cape Cod. While Kennedy and his children were swimming, a large wave suddenly swept over his son David, pulling him out to sea. Kennedy dove into the dangerous surf to rescue him. Both could have died. A few tense moments later, Kennedy rose from the waves, bruised above one eye, clutching David. At the Ambassador Hotel, an unkempt 47-year-old William F. Crossan, an Army sergeant who had served in World War II, kept approaching the hotel desk in the lobby, where Donald Reinke and Gail Farrar worked, to complain about the lack of security there. He mentioned how someone could hide behind the cameras and that they, presumably the Kennedy party, should be careful.
Farrar got the impression that Crossan knew something was going to happen there. Crossan asked for a floor plan of the hotel, but was refused. He took a sheet of paper, drew his own map, and gave it to Ranke. "He is going to die," Crossan said. Neither Ranke nor Farrar got the impression Crossan was making a threat. He seemed genuinely concerned. When Goodwin arrived at Frankenheimer's home, he found Kennedy stretched over two chairs by the pool, his head hanging limply, his body motionless. Goodwin felt a sudden rush of fear. Then he realized the senator was only sleeping. He returned to join the others at the buffet. "God," Goodwin thought, as he served himself food, "I suppose none of us will ever get over John Kennedy." Robert Kennedy himself was not immune from such thoughts. "I can't plan," he had said some months earlier. "Living every day is like Russian roulette." The campaign had shared a similar scare the day before. Monday morning, as Robert Kennedy's motorcade had worked its way through a crowded street in San Francisco's Chinatown, someone had set off a string of firecrackers. Kennedy and the rest in his party thought someone was firing at them. As Newfield recounted, the memory of Dallas flashed through the minds of the press. Was it happening again? Ethel Kennedy, terrified, crouched down. But Robert Kennedy didn't flinch. He kept cool, refusing through will to show fear, shaking hands, waving to the people. The whole incident took perhaps 10 seconds, but the next day we would all remember it. Remember how close to the surface of our consciousness Dallas had been all along. How we all had a secret, fleeting premonition of how the last passionate passage of Robert Kennedy might end. We remembered how John Lindsay of Newsweek had warned us, "This country is going to kill another Kennedy, and then we won't have a country." As the early projections started to come in, Kennedy joined Goodwin and White in Frankenheimer's living room. CBS projected that Kennedy would win 49% of the vote to McCarthy's 41%. "If only we can push up our percentage a point or two," Kennedy lamented, hoping to cross the 50% threshold. "We talked idly," Goodwin would later note, "as if the big victory were already in. Not because we were sure, but because that's the only way politicians can talk." Thane Eugene Caesar, a self-described plumber at Lockheed's Skunk Works facility, where the CIA's top-secret spy planes were made, arrived 5 minutes late for his second job at the Ambassador Hotel. Caesar had signed up to moonlight as an after-hours security guard for Ace Guard Service barely a week earlier. Dressed in his gray Ace uniform, Caesar reported to Fred Murphy, his commander and a former LAPD lieutenant, and William Gardner, the head of the Ambassador Hotel's unarmed, brown-suited security force, who was also a retired LAPD lieutenant. Gardner had asked for the additional help from Ace after realizing he was likely understaffed for the large turnout expected. In Malibu, Kennedy and Dutton clambered into John Frankenheimer's Rolls-Royce Silver Cloud. Frankenheimer sped so fast down the Santa Monica freeway toward the Ambassador Hotel that it caused Kennedy some alarm. "Take it easy," Kennedy said. "Life is too short." As night settled in, the embassy room filled past capacity. Some 1,800 people milled about, chatting as they awaited the results of the California primary and what many believed would be Senator Kennedy's victory speech. Firemen and security officers shooed away supporters and campaign workers from the overflowing embassy room doors, pointing them instead to the smaller ambassador ballroom downstairs. North of the eastern half of the embassy room, and parallel to it, ran a small food preparation area that would become known as the pantry. The room contained 3 steam tables, lined up along an east-west axis on the north side, and a gargantuan ice machine that covered a large portion of the south side. It was not well guarded. Kennedy worker Judy Royer complained of having to constantly clear the room.
Only campaign workers and press people were allowed in that area. But every time Royer entered, unauthorized people were present. Royer was concerned because this room was very close to where Kennedy would be speaking. The embassy room rippled with excitement with each primary update. NBC reported that McCarthy was ahead in the initial count, while CBS predicted a strong Kennedy victory. Kennedy's biggest rival for the nomination, Vice President Hubert Humphrey, wasn't on the ballot in California. He was accumulating delegates the old-fashioned way, by lobbying them directly. He planned to make a play for delegates at the convention in Chicago. Due to a newly installed IBM computer voting system, the vote counting had proceeded more slowly than usual. In the past, ballots had been counted by hand at the precincts all day, so the tallies were nearly done by the time the polls closed. The tallies had then been called in and summarized at the county registrar's office. With the computerized system, however, the ballots had to be driven by truck from each precinct to the central computer in the IBM building, which happened to be across the street from the west end of the Ambassador Hotel. There, the new punch card ballots were fed into a computer to get the count. The new process significantly delayed the count. In Suite 511, Kennedy and his aides strategized. Senator George McGovern called from South Dakota to give Kennedy an update on the primary results there. McGovern told him that Kennedy had received more votes than Humphrey and McCarthy combined. He had won both the Native Americans and the farmers' votes. Down the hall, in Suite 516, Pete Hamill, Jack Newfield, Bud Schulberg, Jimmy Breslin, John Frankenheimer, and another 25 or so members of the press gathered. There were no laptops or cell phones or Blackberries or cable television news either, so telephones rang insistently in the suite, were picked up, and names were called in stage whispers, Hamill recalled. Hamill talked for a while to Frankenheimer about his film, The Manchurian Candidate. "Do you think it could happen in what is laughingly called real life?" Hamill asked. Frankenheimer smiled nervously as he glanced at the suite's door. "Yeah." As the crowd in 511 grew, people spilled into the hallway. At around 9 p.m., Kennedy walked out into the hallway and was immediately besieged. "I like politics," Kennedy said to the reporters. "It's an honorable adventure." Kennedy asked if anyone knew whom he was quoting. No one did. "That was Lord Tweedsmuir. Does anybody here know who he was?" Again, silence. Kennedy told them Lord Tweedsmuir was John Buchan, a Scottish statesman, whose novel The 39 Steps was used as the inspiration for Alfred Hitchcock's famous film of the same name. Kennedy retreated to his room. On and off, Kennedy mingled with the crowd in his suite until he had to leave for an interview with Roger Mudd of CBS. Several floors below, in the embassy room, Sandy Serrano, a Hispanic 21-year-old Youth for Kennedy co-chair for the Pasadena-Altadena area, enjoyed the vodka and orange juice drink a friend had purchased for her. To escape the heat in the room, Serrano walked out the room's southwest fire escape exit, descended the metal fire escape, and re-entered the hotel's sunset room to listen to the Viva Kennedy band. Somewhere above Serrano in the hotel, Roger Mudd grilled Kennedy on live TV. "And you would not be willing to join with Mr. Humphrey in order to help the Democratic Party win? In what way?" Kennedy interrupted. "As vice president," Mudd replied. "In what order?" Kennedy responded, smiling. "Well, I..." Mudd laughed, caught off guard. Kennedy smiled broadly. Mudd asked if Kennedy would consider taking the second slot. "No, I wouldn't. I'd be glad to help the Democratic Party. I believe in the Democratic Party. In what way, I'd have to work out, particularly if Richard Nixon is the nominee of the Republican Party, which I think is unacceptable to the country.
and I have strong disagreements with Hubert Humphrey and the positions he espouses, particularly what he said this week, that he'd step aside if Lyndon Johnson then decides that he wants to run.
You thought that was fairly shoddy politics, I take it?
Kennedy smiled and blinked when Mudd said shoddy.
No, there again. Roger.
Kennedy smiled and blinked again. I think you're either in it or you're not.
Are some of the delegates that are listed as leaning or even committed to the vice president, are they squeezable? Are they solid?
Roger, Kennedy gasped, almost blushing. Your language. I don't like either of those expressions.
Well, isn't that the way you talk behind closed doors? Mudd pushed.
Kennedy shook his head, talking over Mudd, who was starting to laugh.
I don't. Probably somebody else does.
He would, of course, make an effort to win over the delegates, Kennedy acknowledged.
Thank you, and I'll work on my language for the next time, Senator, Mudd ended, chuckling amiably.
Throughout the interview, Kennedy came across as poised, charming, bright, and most of all, presidential.
If he looks like that for the rest of the campaign, Goodwin thought as he watched, we might win.
Michael Wayne, a 5'8" young man in his mid-20s, with dark curly hair, sideburns, and an olive complexion, tried to get into the embassy ballroom, but was turned away. He walked, unchallenged, through the kitchen pantry instead, and into the press area in the small colonial room, just across the hall from the east end of the pantry. There, he managed to beg a Kennedy election night press pass and a similar badge that read, Kennedy for President, Press. Wayne was not a member of the press. Wayne clipped the two badges together with a PT-109 tie clasp he had already obtained from Robert Kennedy 2 weeks earlier at another event at the Ambassador Hotel. He had traded a PT-109 clasp in his possession for one Kennedy had been wearing. Wayne took two Kennedy posters, found his way to Kennedy's fifth-floor suite, walked brazenly through the open door, and begged a second PT-109 tie clasp from a worker there. He ordered a scotch and water at the bar in the suite. Wayne was not a Kennedy supporter. He was not even a Democrat. Elsewhere in the hotel, at around 9 p.m., a girl in a white dress with dark blue polka dots tried to beg a press pass off of Conrad Syme, a 50-year-old photographer. He would remember her later for her persistence and her funny nose, which he thought may have been broken at some point. She was between 5'5" and 5'6" tall, between 25 and 30 years old, Caucasian, with an olive complexion and dark brown hair. Between 10 o'clock and 10:30 p.m., Mrs. Eve Hansen and her sister Nina Ballantyne went up to a bar on the lower level of the hotel. They were approached by a Caucasian girl with a turned-up nose, 25 to 26 years old, wearing a white dress with black or navy blue polka dots, approximately the size of a quarter. "You'll never get served at this end of the bar," the girl told them. "I've been waiting up at the other end. I know." The girl offered to bring them drinks. But Hansen told the girl, essentially, "Watch this," got the attention of the bartender, and ordered drinks. The girl walked away for a bit, and then returned with their drinks a few minutes later, and offered a toast to our next president, without naming whom she had in mind. Hansen noticed three dark-haired men sitting against a wall nearby and wondered why they were lurking there in the dark. Around 11:15 p.m., Murphy moved Caesar from the eastern pantry door to the western one, nearest where Kennedy would soon be speaking. Caesar's job was to make sure no one without the appropriate credentials got into the pantry. But a number of people who had no business being there would enter the pantry under Caesar's watch.
By 11:30 p.m., the crowd in the embassy room was getting restless. It was very hot, and by now the victory was obvious. They started chanting, "We want Kennedy," and occasionally, "We want Chavez." Cesar Chavez was the charismatic founder of what became the United Farm Workers, UFW. Earlier in the year, Chavez had conducted what would be the first of many hunger strikes to draw attention to the plight of the immigrant farm workers in the pesticide-polluted grape fields. He had broken his 25-day water-only fast by accepting bread from Robert Kennedy, who had come to his side to support what Chavez was fighting for. Kennedy had first encountered Chavez in conjunction with Kennedy's work on the Migratory Labor Subcommittee of the Senate Labor Committee. He had flown to California to attend some hearings on a strike Chavez had organized. When a local sheriff, who had arrested some lawfully picketing farm workers, spoke, Kennedy let the sheriff have it with both barrels. "This is the most interesting concept. How can you go arrest somebody if they haven't violated the law? Can I suggest during the luncheon period that the sheriff and district attorney read the Constitution of the United States?" Kennedy hadn't endeared himself to law enforcement with his comments, but the farm workers loved him, and by day's end, the feeling was mutual. Kennedy defended the farm workers against the charge that they were communists, telling the press they were simply struggling for their rights. "Robert didn't come to us and tell us what was good for us," Dolores Huerta, Chavez's lieutenant and the farm workers' chief negotiator, explained later. "He came to us and asked two questions. What do you want? And how can I help?" That's why we loved him. Chavez had been both grateful and protective. "He shouldn't go too far," he had warned Huerta, "because it's only going to hurt him." Chavez and Huerta were both at the hotel that night to share the upcoming victory with their beloved ally. On and off, the crowd in the embassy room launched into what had become the unofficial campaign song, a Woody Guthrie classic, slightly altered. "This man is your man, this man is my man, from California to the New York Island, from the Redwood Forest to the Gulf Stream waters, this man is Robert Kennedy. Let us stop the fighting, start reuniting, increase our labors to help our neighbors. This nation needs now a man who leads now. That man is Robert Kennedy. He walks with all men. He talks with all men. In times of crisis, he is the right man. For peace in our land, for peace in all lands, the man is Robert Kennedy." At some point during the celebration, a copy of these lyrics would end up in the pocket of a short, dark, curly-haired, olive-skinned young immigrant who was about to become infamous. Upstairs, Kennedy talked briefly to Bud Schulberg, the screenwriter whose film On the Waterfront had won him an Academy Award. After the Watts riots in 1965, Schulberg had formed the Watts Writers Workshop and the Douglas House Theater. "I think you touched a nerve," Kennedy told Schulberg. "I think that workshop idea of yours is a kind of throwback to the Federal Theater and Writers Project of the New Deal. We have to encourage not just mechanical skills, but creative talent on a national scale. I'll do what I can." Kennedy continued, but was interrupted by the Speaker of the California Assembly, Jesse Unruh. Kennedy's victory was clear, and his margin was substantial. It was time to go down to speak to the crowd. As he left the room, Pete Hamill remembered the mood was light, almost giddy. When Kennedy and his aides left his suite and proceeded to the elevator, Michael Wayne followed. Kennedy asked if the elevator opened to the lobby. He had nearly been mauled by crowds recently and hoped to avoid wading through them. Uno Tiemensen of the Ambassador Hotel's staff took Kennedy instead to the freight elevator, which opened into the kitchen area. Wayne and the press went down in a second elevator nearby. Kennedy and his entourage walked through the kitchen into the pantry. There, Michael Wayne got Kennedy to stop and sign one of the two posters he was carrying. Kennedy proceeded into the embassy ballroom to make his acceptance speech, with his entourage following closely behind. It was midnight, in more ways than anyone could have known at the time. "We want Kennedy! We want Kennedy!" The crowd's chants were deafening as Kennedy tried to get a word in. "Thank you very much," he said for the third time as he waited for the crowd to calm down. His wife Ethel stood next to him on the stand. He began by congratulating Los Angeles Dodgers pitcher Don Drysdale, who had just completed his sixth straight shutout. "I hope we have as good fortune in our campaign," Kennedy said, a comment whose irony would only be evident after the fact. Drysdale's run would end in his next game. Kennedy's run would end in the next room. Serrano returned to the embassy room after hearing rumbles of, "He's here!" But the room was so thick with people, and it was so hot inside, that Serrano took to the southwestern fire escape a second time and sat about halfway down the steps. She reveled in the moment. She had worked very hard on his campaign. Serrano had originally met Robert Kennedy in D.C. in 1965. He had stepped on her foot in an elevator by mistake, and she had shoved him away. She'd kept a copy of the speech he had given that night, a copy he had provided to her. As she rested there, two young men and a young woman came up the stairs. "Excuse me," the girl said as the trio walked past her and up into the back of the ballroom. The two men could have been Mexicans, Serrano thought. In the darkness of night, they both appeared to have dark hair, one with straight hair and the other with curly hair. The taller one was maybe 5'7", a little overweight, with straight hair and wearing a gold sweater. The curly-haired guy was a few inches shorter than his companion and seemed borracho, she thought. Not drunk, just messy. Something. She couldn't put her finger on it, but he just didn't seem to fit in with the upbeat, well-dressed crowd. The girl was in her mid-twenties, had light skin, was about 5'6" tall, and had a good figure. Her dark hair was done up in a bouffant, and she didn't appear to be wearing much makeup. She had a funny, turned-up nose. The girl wore black shoes and a white dress with dark polka dots. In the same southwest corner of the ballroom where the trio entered the embassy ballroom, Mary Whalen and her friend Felicia Masuri, both married to NBC executives, noticed a 6-foot-tall, heavy-set, swarthy man in his 40s in a maroon coat. He held something to his face that looked like a leather-covered small transistor or radio. Masuri thought his manner indicated a sense of urgency. Kennedy thanked all who had helped on his campaign, joking with the crowd by calling his brother-in-law Steve Smith, who was running his campaign, ruthless. Kennedy also expressed his gratitude to my dog Freckles, who's been maligned. And I'm not doing this in the order of importance, but I also, Kennedy broke and chuckled as he realized what he'd just done, want to thank my wife, Ethel. The crowd went wild. Her patience during this whole effort is, he said, turning away from the crowd to say to her face, quietly and sincerely, fantastic. She acknowledged his thanks with a beaming smile. He thanked Chavez, Huerta, and Paul Schrade, the Western Regional Director of the UAW. He thanked the students and others who had worked so hard on his campaign. He acknowledged the support of the African-American community, particularly Rayford Johnson, a former Olympic decathlon champion, and Roosevelt Rosie Greer, a former Los Angeles Rams defensive tackle, both of whom were serving as unofficial bodyguards. After the thank yous, he turned to the crisis facing the nation,
the deep divide between those with the power and those without it. What I think is quite clear is that we can work together in the last analysis, and that what has been going on within the United States over the period of the last 3 years, the divisions, whether it's between blacks and whites, between the poor and the more affluent, or between age groups, or on the war in Vietnam, that we can start to work together. We are a great country, an unselfish country, and a compassionate country, and I intend to make that my basis for running. The country wants to move in a different direction. We want to deal with our own problems within our own country, and we want peace in Vietnam. A loud cheer burst out. My thanks to all of you. And now it's on to Chicago, and let's win there. He flashed a victory sign and brushed the hair from his forehead. The crowd cheered for a long time, whistling and hooting, waving hats and chanting. Just steps away in the pantry, Vincent DiPiero, an 18-year-old waiter and political junkie, waited. DiPiero had not been scheduled to work that night, but his father, Angelo DiPiero, the senior maitre d'hotel, had told him of Kennedy's appearance. Vince had arrived shortly before midnight in the hopes of shaking the senator's hand. In the pantry, Vince noticed a person who looked sick. A short, Hispanic-looking young man with curly hair, holding his hand to his stomach. But Vince's attention was momentarily diverted by a dark-haired, attractive girl with a good figure and a funny nose in a white dress with black polka dots. The curly-haired man said something to the girl as he stood on a tray rack, and she smiled. Vince thought the girl seemed to be holding him. To thunderous cheers of, "We want Bobby," Kennedy started to exit the stage to his right, but was called to the left, since his next destination, as decided by Fred Dutton during his speech, was the Colonial Room, where the newsmen of the printed press were working. The quickest way from either side of the stage to the Colonial Room was through the pantry. But by exiting to the back of the stage instead of the right, Kennedy was not following his unofficial bodyguard, former FBI man Bill Berry, who was waiting stage right. Berry had planned to walk in front of Kennedy to protect him. But Kennedy was now far ahead of him, unprotected from the front, as Berry pushed through the crowd trying to catch up. Carl Euchre, a hotel maitre d', grabbed Kennedy's right wrist and led him east toward the pantry. As they passed through the swinging double doors at the west end of the pantry, ace guard Caesar took hold of Kennedy's right elbow, guiding him forward. Reporters Richard Drew and Boris Yarrow were at the door as Kennedy entered. Yarrow raised his camera. "Hey, Boris, you missed him," Drew said as Kennedy walked by. Drew and Yarrow followed Kennedy into the pantry. Caesar pushed people away with his free right hand if they got too close. Rosie Greer walked behind them, with Ethel and Paul Schrade trailing Greer. Taped to the wall was a hand-lettered sign that said, "The Once and Future King." The tiny room at that moment held, by the LAPD's count, 77 people. At the eastern end of the room stood several people, including Michael Wayne. A girl in a polka dot dress, a short, olive-skinned, curly-haired man, and a teenage volunteer named Lisa Urso, who focused her attention on Kennedy as he approached. Kennedy's progress through the room was slow. He kept breaking from Euchre and Caesar to shake hands with many of the staff in the room, including Vince DiPiero, Martin Petruski, and busboy Jesus Perez. Kennedy passed the large ice-making machine to his right, stopped again, and shook the hand of busboy Juan Romero. The room's three steam tables were lined up ahead and to Kennedy's left, along the northern side of the little room. Vince DiPiero saw the young man who had been talking to the girl in the polka dot dress climb down from the tray rack at the east end of the ice machine, on the south side of the room, and cross north toward the senator. Euchre reclaimed Kennedy's right hand and turned to go. As Kennedy turned to follow Euchre, Romero noticed a young man approaching Kennedy. One of the waiters nearby, Martin Petruski, saw a smile on the young man's face as he crossed the room. Urso saw the man from behind as he moved between her and Kennedy. As the young man moved his arm across his body, her first thought was that he was reaching out to shake Kennedy's hand. Then she realized he was reaching for a gun. Photographer Yarrow saw two men standing next to the senator move off to the right as the shooting began. Richard Lubick, a TV producer, was an arm's length from the senator when he saw an arm with a gun point at Kennedy's head. He didn't see a face, only a hand with a gun. Frank Burns, a personal advisor to Speaker Unruh, who was behind Kennedy with his eyes fixed on his back as the shooting started, focused on an arm and a gun to his right that was close to the senator. Euchre heard a pop and saw what looked like little bits of paper falling. Burns and Romero felt searing sensations on their cheeks. Urso and Vince DiPiero saw the flash of the first shot. Kennedy threw up his hands, staggered, and twisted left. Booker Griffin, publicity director for the Negro Industrial Economic Union, had entered the pantry at the eastern end just before the first shot. He heard two sounds that he didn't think of as shots until he saw a man with a gun. When he saw Kennedy throw up his hands, Griffin ran forward to help him. Euchre felt Kennedy slip from his grip as he heard what he realized was a second shot. He turned back, in time to see Kennedy throw up his hands and twist to his left. Richard Drew thought someone lowered Kennedy to the ground. Dunn Gifford, an administrative assistant to Robert's brother Edward, thought Kennedy fell unaided to the ground. Caesar reported that he had grabbed the senator as they both fell. Caesar's clip-on tie lay on the ground next to Kennedy's outstretched hand, as if Kennedy had somehow pulled it off. Roger Mudd said he was with Ethel at that moment. And we heard these shots. It was like Hades, this screaming that was going on. It was absolutely unworldly. It was awful. You weren't prepared for it. Jim Wilson, one of the TV cameramen, was absolutely going out of his mind. He was so frustrated, so frozen. Several besides Kennedy were hit by stray bullets. Schrade, who was just behind Kennedy, was shot in the forehead and collapsed to the ground. William Weisel, a 30-year-old ABC associate director, took a bullet in his abdomen. 19-year-old Ira Goldstein was hit in his left hip. 17-year-old Irwin Stroll received a bullet in his left shin. Elizabeth Evans was struck in the head. Juan Romero knelt down to help Kennedy. A bystander handed Romero a rosary, which Romero pressed into Kennedy's hand, wrapping it around his right thumb so it wouldn't slip off. Both DiPiero and Romero heard Kennedy ask, "Is everybody okay?" After the shot stopped, Lubick saw that the guard to his left was holding a gun that was pointed at the floor. From the embassy room, the shots sounded like little more than balloons popping. Suddenly, screams shattered the celebration. People near the pantry door snapped to attention at emerging news. Necks craned and strained, looking in the direction of the pantry. Within seconds, a strange mixture of stunned silence and sporadic screaming ensued. George Green had just entered the pantry from the west end when he heard popping sounds. He saw a girl in a polka-dot dress and a tall, thin man running away from him. He noticed them because they seemed to be the only ones intent on getting out of the pantry, while everyone else was trying to get in. Evan Freed, a freelance press photographer, was at the east end of the pantry when the shooting began. As people tried to leave the pantry, he found himself pinned at the east end. He also saw a girl that he thought was wearing a polka-dot dress and a tall, dark-haired male companion run through a door to his right, out of the pantry. The door to his right led north into the main kitchen. Ace guard Jack Merritt was near the front doors to the embassy ballroom, just outside the east end of the pantry, when someone yelled that Kennedy had been shot. He drew his gun and ran into the pantry, just in time to see a girl in a white dress with dark polka dots, accompanied by two men, a tall, dark-haired man, and a short male, run out of the pantry through a northern exit into the main kitchen. From the kitchen, there were a number of ways out. One could go downstairs and out the building. One could cut through the lobby, behind or into the embassy room, or into the gold room, which connected with the embassy room. One could also re-enter the pantry at the west end, and from there, enter the embassy room and exit out the southwestern fire escape door. While traveling from the west end of the pantry to the southwestern fire escape exit himself, to ask the guard at the bottom of the fire escape to call an ambulance, 13-year-old Ronald Panda noticed a girl in a white dress with black polka dots and a ruffled collar in the embassy room. He wouldn't have seen her if she was behind him. Clearly, she was in front of him. On the fire escape steps, Serrano heard what she thought were 6 backfires from a car. She looked around for the car making this noise. Seconds later, 2 of the 3 people who had passed her earlier came running down the stairs. The girl in the polka dot dress came first, followed closely by the man in the gold sweater. They nearly stepped on Serrano. The girl was shouting, excitedly, "We shot him! We shot him!" Serrano asked, "Who did you shoot?" "Senator Kennedy," the girl said, as the 2 ran down the stairs and out into the darkness toward the back parking lot. Serrano didn't believe it at first. She climbed down to the hotel's ground floor level and asked the guard at the ambassador room, below the embassy room, if Kennedy had been shot. "You're drunk," the guard said, blowing her off. She next asked a group of people down there if they'd heard if Kennedy had been shot. "You're crazy," they told her. Despite their responses, Serrano had the feeling something was terribly wrong. In the same southwest corner where the girl in the polka dot dress and the man in the gold shirt had just exited, the man who had been holding what appeared to be a radio or transmitter to his cheek turned to Mary Whalen and Felicia Missouri, who had been sitting on a packing crate at the rear of the ballroom, and told the 2 women words to the effect, "You've seen me here all evening, haven't you? You witnessed the fact that I was standing here when the senator departed. Remember, you have seen me here. Don't forget." Then the man disappeared. Missouri felt he was trying to establish he was in her view when Senator Kennedy was shot. During the shooting, while pinned at what was likely the southeast end of the pantry, Freed saw a curly, dark-haired man run out the door to his left, chased by a person who was yelling, "Stop him! Get him!" William Singer saw a man pushing his way through the crowd, carrying a rolled-up poster over a yard long, about 4 inches to 6 inches in diameter, with something black inside. Several people were now saying, "Stop that man!" Joseph Klein and Patty Nelson were just outside the embassy room in the main lobby when they saw a man running out of the pantry carrying a package. Patty thought she saw a gun inside what appeared initially to her to be a blue canvas type of cloth that could well have been a gun case. She described seeing about 6 inches of a wooden stock of a rifle or a shotgun protruding from the blue canvas. She was quite sure that the wood that protruded from this blue canvas was definitely the stock of a gun. Klein also thought he saw an object wrapped in some sort of blue material. The object appeared to be larger at one end than at the other. Klein tried to chase the man, but he disappeared out the door. "My God,
He had a gun, and we let him get by, Klein said. Steve Fontanini, a photographer for the Los Angeles Times, saw a man running through the lobby and, thinking he might have been the shooter, gave chase. Gregory Ross Clayton, a Rafferty campaign worker, was in the lobby on his way to the embassy room when he heard what sounded like firecrackers. Suddenly, he saw a man running out and heard someone yelling, "Stop that man," so he chased and tackled him. Clayton recognized the running man as one of four men he had seen in a group with a woman in a polka dot dress earlier that night by the lobby fountain. Ace security guard Augustus Mallard ran over and helped Clayton subdue the man. Mallard handcuffed him, a moment photographer Fontanini captured on camera. Mallard turned the man over to the police, who quickly learned his name was Michael Wayne. Inside the pantry, the struggle continued. By the third shot, Euchre grabbed the small gunman and threw his right arm around the young man's neck. Euchre grabbed the gun hand in his left and tried to point it away from the crowd. Another maitre d', Edward Manasian, grabbed the shooter around the waist. Euchre swung the man around and pushed him down onto the steam table. Rosie Greer joined the struggle, trying to wrestle the gun from the shooter's hand. Rayford jumped in as well, as did several others, including Barry and Burns. Robert Healy, a reporter for the Boston Globe, saw four or five flashes and heard the same number of shots. He jumped up on the steam tables and ran to the end, where he saw a struggle going on at his feet. It struck him as unusual that a man as large as Rosie Greer was having so much trouble getting the gun from such a small man. Barry got the gun out of the shooter's hand and put it on the steam table, but the gunman grabbed it right back. Someone pounded the gunman's hand on the table, and the gun fell out. Reporter Boris Yarrow reached out and grabbed it, but another man ripped it from Yarrow. Amazingly, that gun, or some gun, found its way back into the suspect's hand, despite the fact that several large men were then holding him. Andrew West, the news director for radio station KRKD, had entered the pantry just as shots were being fired. He instinctively turned on his tape recorder and captured the scene vividly. West would later tell the FBI he couldn't identify the shooter because his attention had been focused entirely on the gun, as his broadcast made clear. Senator Kennedy has been shot. Oh my God, I am right here, and Rafer Johnson has hold of the man who apparently has fired the shot. He still has the gun. The gun is pointed at me right at this moment. Get the gun. Get the gun. Get his thumb. Get his thumb. Get a hold of his thumb and break it. That's it, Rafer. Get it. Okay, now, hold on to the gun. Greer finally wrested the gun from the shooter. Joseph Lahive tried to take it from him, but Greer held on until Rafer Johnson came up, at which point Greer and Lahive released the gun to Rafer. Rafer wisely refused to give the gun to anyone on the scene. He wanted to take it to the police himself. Bystanders were pummeling the shooter. Speaker Unruh moved quickly to ensure no one killed the suspect before they figured out what had happened. "We want him alive," Lahive and Greer yelled. People were vividly aware of how Jack Ruby shot Lee Harvey Oswald in Dallas just 4.5 years earlier. "We don't want another Oswald," Unruh yelled. "We don't want another Oswald," West echoed. On the stage of the embassy room, a man pushed his way to the microphone, asking, "Is there a doctor in the house?" Men and women screamed and shouted as Steve Smith asked people from the podium to please clear the room so that medical people could get to the senator and the other victims. Dr. Stanley Abo, whose wife was a campaign worker for Kennedy, had already made his way into the pantry. He stopped at Paul Schrade, whom he mistakenly thought was Steve Smith, then moved on to Kennedy and knelt down beside him. Kennedy had a problem with one eye, but otherwise seemed quite lucid. But his breathing was shallow, and his pulse was slow. Kennedy looked around for his wife and called her name several times. Dr. Abo felt for the wound and soon found a hole in the head just behind the right ear. He worried the slow pulse might be due to intracranial pressure, so he pressed his finger on the wound to stimulate the bleeding, to relieve cranial pressure, and to prevent blood from clotting there. Kennedy grimaced in pain. Ethel found her way to his side, bringing a bag of ice, which Abo took and applied to Kennedy's head. "Oh, Ethel," Abo heard Kennedy say. Elsewhere in the hotel, Lillian Butler, a hotel phone operator, called the police department. "This is the Ambassador Hotel. Do you hear me?" Butler queried. "Yeah," Wayne G. Hathaway, a communications division officer, replied from Parker Center. "I hear you." "They have an emergency. They want the police to the kitchen right away."
"What kind of emergency?"
"I don't know, honey," Butler replied. "It's some kind of an emergency. I don't know what happened. You know we have a Kennedy here tonight."
"Big deal," Officer Hathaway said, with obvious disdain.
"Do you want me to find out what it is?"
"Yes, please."
"Hold on." Ruby Ford then came on the line. My banquet maitre d' reported that Senator Kennedy has been shot."
"He's been shot?"
Hathaway asked in a very different, almost plaintive, tone.
"What's the address there, please?"
LAPD Sergeant Paul Chirago was literally driving past the back of the hotel when, at 12:23 a.m., he heard a call about an ambulance shooting at the Ambassador. Chirago turned quickly into the back parking lot and began setting up a command post. During Kennedy's speech, Don Weston, a driver for the Kennedy party that night, had left the hotel to line the cars up to take the Kennedy party to a popular club downtown. He had tried to listen to Kennedy's speech on the radio, but there was a problem with his antenna. He got out of the car to fix it, leaving the door open so he could hear the radio. Suddenly, he heard someone asking for a doctor. He realized he needed to make room for an ambulance and backed up his car just as the first policeman arrived. Weston heard a group of people at the back of the hotel talking to the police about a man whom they saw running out the back parking lot. Some people in the crowd pointed in the direction the man had gone, and two policemen took off after him. Sergeant Chiraga apparently received this information because he immediately broadcast a description of a suspect just before 12:29 a.m. Description: suspect of shooting at 3400 Wilshire Boulevard. Male Caucasian, 20 to 22, 6'2", very thin build, blonde curly hair, wearing brown pants and shirt. It's a light tan shirt. Direction taken unknown. A response came back that the suspect was in custody, but when Chiraga asked for confirmation, he was told, "Unable to determine whether actual suspect is in custody or person in custody is the suspect." Jim Bush, a Students for Kennedy volunteer, had pulled into the parking lot on the southern side of the hotel with his sister Andrea and their friend Richard Rittner, just as Kennedy's speech, which they had been listening to on the radio, was ending. They were still listening when they heard a commotion, followed by Smith's call for a doctor. Suddenly, the three noticed a male and female hurrying past their car. Jim threw his arm out to stop the man. The woman, wearing a long dark coat, hurried past and stopped a few feet away. Jim asked the man what had happened, and the man said he'd just shaken the senator's hand when a man stepped forward, pulled a gun from his trousers, and fired at Kennedy. Just then, they saw five patrol cars pull up. Andrea felt there was something strange about these two, so the trio told officers J.J. Fedrizzi and L.E. Deloche enough to lead them to believe that the male and female were possibly fleeing the scene. Rittner described the male as Mexican, about 5'9" and stocky, and the girl as having dark brown or black, medium-length hair.
Deloche immediately asked the communications division to seal off the area and broadcast the following suspect descriptions. Number 1, male, Latin, 30 to 35, 5'9½", stocky, wearing a wool hunter's hat with a small brim. Number 2, described as a female Caucasian, no further description.
LAPD Chief of Detectives Robert A. Houghton was on vacation in Yosemite. He had left instructions for how he could be reached in an emergency, but no one apparently followed those instructions. In his absence, Inspector John Powers, the acting commander of the LAPD detectives, took control of the crime scene and gave primary authority to the nearby Rampart Station. Several officers responded to the ambassador call immediately, including officers Travis White and the young police academy graduate he was training, Arthur Placencia. When they entered the pantry, they found Rosie Greer lying on the suspect to hold him down. Frank Burns had the suspect's legs, and Euchre had the small man in a headlock. Unruh was keeping people off the suspect so no one could kill him before he stood trial. Officer White asked who had the gun. Somebody indicated Rafer had it, so White asked for the gun, but Johnson refused to turn it over at that point, possibly because he wasn't sure these were actual policemen. Rosie Greer didn't want to release the suspect to the police, but White and Placencia were finally able to pry the suspect free. One officer present, as White and Placencia took the suspect away, Randolph Adair, told Dan Mulday years later, "The guy was real confused. It was like it didn't exactly hit him what he had done. He had a blank, glassed-over look on his face, like he wasn't in complete control of his mind at the time." As the officers put the suspect in the car, Jesse Unruh jumped, uninvited, into the back seat with him. The police car sped 3 miles in 3 minutes to transport the suspect from the Ambassador Hotel to the Rampart Station. The suspect was very cool and said nothing but yes to questions Officer Placencia put to him about understanding his rights, wishing to remain silent, and wishing to have an attorney present. The only time he said anything else was when Unruh asked the suspect the question everyone wanted answered, "Why did you shoot him?" The LAPD recorded the response as, "You think I'm crazy, so you can use it as evidence against me?" In the car, the rookie Placencia flashed lights in the suspect's eyes. Placencia thought the suspect's pupils looked dilated and wondered if he was under the influence of alcohol or a drug. Placencia's partner, the more experienced White, redid this check when they arrived at the station a few minutes later, because Placencia had only looked at the suspect's eyes to make his assessment. White checked the suspect's eyes, then Placencia's, for comparison. White reported that the suspect's eyes behaved normally, that the man did not appear to be intoxicated. When they reached Rampart, although the officers placed the suspect in the breathalyzer room, the suspect was not given a breathalyzer test. White left to inform the watch commander of their arrival. Unruh waited with the suspect until he was transferred to Interrogation Room B. At 12:30 a.m., Kennedy was rushed by ambulance to Central Receiving Hospital, a police hospital which serviced criminals and victims of crime, and later became the site of a new Rampart police station, where Dr. Faustin Basiloskis and Dr. Albert Holt examined him. Dr. Holt found 2 bullet wounds and recommended brain surgery and suggested getting Dr. Henry Cuneo. Minutes later, the police radio chatter indicated confusion. One officer asked if there was a command post set up and if the suspect was in custody. Another officer responded, "He left there approximately 5 minutes ago. He was taken into custody in the police car, and there was another suspect being held within the building, and I sent Nunley into 1 suspect in custody, 1 suspect in the building. Is there a supervisor at the station?" asked the first officer.
At the command post, Shiraga continued to communicate with control. Until I establish, or at least have been informed at the CP, command post, that the suspect is in custody, Shiraga broadcast. Request you repeat the broadcast of suspect description I gave earlier this evening. Repeat at least every 10 minutes on all frequencies. Another officer responded. The description we have is a male Latin, 25-26, 5'5", bushy hair, dark eyes, light build, wearing a blue jacket and blue Levi's and blue tennis shoes. Do you have anything to add? That's not the description I put out, Shiraga objected. The description I put out was a male Caucasian, 20-22, approximately 6'-6'2, sandy blonde curly hair, and wearing brown pants and a light tan shirt. Several times throughout the first 90 minutes after the shooting, control noted to Shiraga that his radio was breaking up. Ethel, Pierre Salinger, astronaut John Glenn, and several of Kennedy's friends and aides gathered at Central Receiving Hospital, where Kennedy had been brought by the police. Kennedy was given oxygen and fed intravenously, but it was clear Kennedy would need brain surgery, which Good Samaritan Hospital was better equipped to handle, so Kennedy was transferred. There, Kennedy was given a tracheotomy to help his breathing. 2 minutes later, Kennedy stopped breathing and was immediately put on a respirator. The police prevented unauthorized personnel from entering the sealed fifth floor containing the intensive care ward where Robert Kennedy was being examined. Several times, the police had to turn back people clad in hospital-type clothing. Not even other doctors were allowed in the ward without permission. Their barricade was so effective, they nearly prevented Dr. Henry Cuneo, one of Los Angeles' best brain surgeons, from reaching the senator. Outside Good Samaritan, a somber crowd gathered. People lit candles, cried, prayed, and held their breath as they waited for word from the men battling to save his life. Some 270 miles away, secluded in his private penthouse suite at the Desert Inn in Las Vegas, the eccentric billionaire Howard Hughes tuned in to watch the only TV station still broadcasting in his area at that hour, the CBS affiliate that he owned. He had watched Kennedy's victory speech and was still watching when the report came in that Robert Kennedy had been shot. He would watch the continuing coverage nearly nonstop for the next 26 hours.
Nightmare. I was concentrating on him because I saw the gun going like that, so I didn't really look around at that point. If I hadn't seen the gun, I probably would have looked a little more. The prospect of a second Kennedy assassination was a nightmare. People were spread out all over the grounds of the hotel, screaming and crying. Crowds of people gathered at the fountain in the lobby of the Ambassador Hotel, sobbing and praying. Some dipped their hands in the water from the fountain and crossed themselves in the Catholic tradition. Inside the Rampart Station, Sergeant William Jordan, the Night Watch Detective Commander, was dealing with a different kind of nightmare. He had been utterly unable to identify the suspect in custody. The dark, young, curly-haired suspect number one had no identifying information on him. No business card, no wallet, and the suspect wasn't helping. "What is your name, sir?" Sergeant William Jordan, the Night Watch Detective Commander, asked the suspect. The suspect did not answer. Unable to determine if the suspect had been read his rights, Jordan gave the suspect the official admonition required in the wake of the Supreme Court ruling in the case of Miranda v. Arizona in 1966. "I have to advise you that you have the right to remain silent, that if you give up the right to remain silent, anything you say can be used against you in a court of law. You have a right to an attorney and have an attorney present during any questioning. And if you desire this and cannot afford one, one will be appointed for you without charge before any questioning. Do you understand your rights?"
"Is this of the
what the officers told me in the car? The suspect queried. I have no idea, sir, at this point, what you were told.
Jordan started to repeat the Miranda admonition, but was interrupted by another officer on an administrative matter. The suspect asked Jordan to start afresh a third time. Jordan obliged. The suspect also asked Jordan for his name, even though Jordan had already given it. It was as if Jordan's words were simply not being recorded in the suspect's brain. The suspect finally said he wished to remain silent. Jordan said he'd count the money from the man's pockets, but the suspect did not wish to speak, even to confirm the count. At the Ambassador Hotel, Lieutenant Robert Sillings, the watch commander, arrived at Sergeant Shiraga's command post and assessed the situation. Many of the evening's guests wanted to leave, but the police wanted to talk to everyone, so Shiraga ordered arriving officers to create a perimeter around the hotel. Arrangements were made to bus witnesses to the Rampart Station for interviews. Two members of the LAPD's Intelligence Division tried to segregate witnesses who had seen or heard something in the pantry from the rest of the witnesses. They took Juan Romero, Vince DiPiero, and other pantry witnesses to the Gold Room, a small room adjacent to the large embassy room. Confusion reigned. According to a contemporaneous LAPD log, at 12:50 a.m., Lieutenant Sillings said on TV that the suspect, a 6'4" male Caucasian, was in custody. The suspect Jordan was interviewing, however, was a foot shorter. Another log item stated the suspect had been shot in the leg. The suspect taken from the pantry had not been pierced by any bullet, although his ankle had been twisted in the struggle. According to someone from administrative services at the Rampart Station, there were several suspects in custody. For the next 20 minutes, repeated references to the other suspects in custody were broadcast over police radio. LAPD Captain Hugh Brown and Detective Inspector John Powers arrived at the Rampart Station at 1 a.m. to find the suspect still unidentified. This troubled them. Thoughts of accomplices were much on the minds of both Brown and Powers. Had the man they were holding really been alone? Could it possibly be a foreign conspiracy? Could it be the first in a series of assassinations planned in the midst of national election campaigns in order to paralyze the entire nation? Or was this perhaps the second? Just 2 months had gone by since Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was murdered. As yet, there was no suspect in that killing. Could it possibly be the third? Dallas? Memphis? Los Angeles? Jordan was arranging to transfer the suspect from Rampart to the newly opened Parker Center downtown when he was handed a note with Shiraga's description of a 6'2" blonde suspect. Jordan wondered if the suspect he had been questioning was, in fact, the actual, or only, shooter. At Rampart, LAPD detectives Michael McGann and Robert Calkins, who had only just arrived themselves, interviewed Rayford Johnson. I thought it was a balloon, the first shot, because I didn't see anything. I looked, and then the second shot, I saw smoke, and I saw, like, something from a, like a, the residue from a bullet or cap. Looked like a cap gun throwing off the residue. And when I saw that, I fought my way through. By the time I got there, the fellow had, I don't know how many shots. I couldn't count them, to tell you the truth. But I know it was like 4 or 5. Sergeant Calkins asked Rafer where the guy was shooting from. The guy was standing right in front of him, Rafer answered. This information caused a stir in the room, presumably because the police knew by this time that Kennedy had been shot from behind. McGann asked for the gun. Calkins inspected it. Fired every one of them, he said. No wonder everybody's laying on the ground. McGann and Calkins focused on the type of gun. McGann, we have an Iver. Calkins, Iver Johnson. McGann,
Ivor Johnson, cadet, model 55A. Calkins. More of these goddamn guns kill more people. McGann. Model number 50. Number 56SA. The serial number is H53725. Calkins. 8 shots expended. Calkins asked Rafer. Everybody's interested. Real big. Now, is this conspiracy? Is there more than one guy? And what do we have to prove it? That's the big deal now, so... In other words, is there anything to make you believe there was another person there? McGann interrupted. No, Rafer said, but he immediately qualified his answer. I wouldn't. Not me. See, maybe Rosie's a little taller than I am, and was a little closer to the senator. I heard the second shot, and I saw people start to move, and I just pushed my way through. I was looking at the guy at this point, and I didn't notice what was around. I was just trying to get to him. I really couldn't tell you anything about the people around at that point. I just wasn't looking. McGann took him through the whole event again, right up until he saw the second shot. And then you immediately saw this cloud of smoke coming from where this suspect, who you ultimately took the gun away from, was standing? Rafer repeated that he had seen smoke, as well as something else. He reported seeing these particles flying in the air, like, you know, expended... Calkins cut him off before Rafer could finish with the likely word, caps. From Rafer's description, it sounded as if the suspect was firing blanks, not bullets. When a blank is fired, a wad of paper, the cap that seals in the gunpowder, burns quickly, creating a little shower of paper ash residue from the expended cap. It was your opinion at that time that somebody was firing a gun. Is that right? Calkins asked, in an apparent effort to eliminate that possibility. Yeah, I thought it was a gun at that point, Rafer responded. I still wasn't sure, but I just wanted to get up there, you know, and see what was going on. Anything else at all that you can think of that happened regarding the suspect, or possible other suspect, or anything that was said that led you to believe that there would be another suspect possibly involved? No, nothing, Rafer responded. But again, he qualified his statement. I was concentrating on him because I saw the gun going like that, so I didn't really look around at that point. If I hadn't seen the gun, I probably would have looked a little more. At the Ambassador Hotel, KTLA reporters Larry Shear and Stan Chambers described the scene. Shear told the camera, I understand, and it is purely hearsay, that there were 4 men back there that were apparently waiting for the group to come out. Whether they were caught or escaped, I do not know. Chambers reported, out here on the floor of the ballroom, we did not hear the shots, but we were told that there were apparently 4 men back there. One man who was standing near me a few minutes ago indicated that he saw 4 flashes. He thought they were flashbulbs. They may have been shots from a gun. On NBC, Joseph LaHive described what he heard. I was directly behind the senator, about 3 or 4 people behind him, when I heard the firecracker barrage of shots come off. We knew that it wasn't balloons cracking or anything. It was drastic. So we plowed through. He joined in the struggle with the suspect. We just wanted to make sure that the suspect was not hurt any more than being held, so he would be available for questioning rather than the incident that happened before, LaHive said, referring to the fact that Lee Harvey Oswald had been murdered while in police custody. LaHive thought the shooter might have been Filipino and 30 years old. I didn't even see the other suspect, he said, referring to reports of others. I only saw the one suspect. It was almost like rapid fire. The guy must have just squeezed them off as fast as he could. If there were 2 people, that would account for the seeming sequence of shots. At 1:30 a.m., Kartha Deloach, assistant to J. Edgar Hoover, the director of the FBI, responded to a request from Ted Sorensen and Pierre Salinger to provide protection to the Kennedy family at their home. Deloach also advised Los Angeles FBI Supervisor William Nolan that, under no circumstances should the FBI give the impression that we are investigating this matter. An odd statement for a high-level crime in which the suspect hadn't even been identified. That position would change in a few hours. Attorney General Ramsey Clark asked the FBI to investigate the crime under the Civil Rights Act of 1968 and the Voting Rights Act of 1965. An FBI codename of Kensalt, Kennedy Assault, was designated for their investigation. At Good Samaritan, X-rays were taken of Kennedy's head, neck, chest, and right shoulder, all of which had been penetrated by bullets. One bullet had passed harmlessly through his clothing at close range, at a steep upward angle. Another had passed through his chest, from back to front, at a similarly steep upward angle, and exited his body. A third bullet had entered his right armpit and lodged in the base of his neck. But the fourth bullet was the one that was worrying the doctors. It had shattered in his brain. Kennedy's prognosis was extremely poor, and the doctors knew they were dealing with an absolute disaster. Nonetheless, they began to prep Kennedy for surgery. Outside the hospital, people gathered, holding signs, praying that Kennedy would recover. 2 miles away, Sergeant Robert E. Lindblom of the Los Angeles Sheriff's Office led a squad of deputies, which included Lieutenant Beto Keenest, Sergeant John Barber, Deputy Walter Tew, and Deputy Tom Berenger, into the embassy ballroom. There, they met LAPD Sergeants Jones and Rollon. Together, these LAPD and LASO officers formed a wedge and cleared the crime scene. Newsmen and their equipment were moved only by the sheer number of officers and deputies. Inside the pantry, Berenger saw a man in a tuxedo trying to take a bullet out of the wall with a silver knife, ostensibly for a souvenir. After someone pulled the 4x3/4-inch pine wood door jamb casing off the front of the swinging doorframe, photographs were eventually taken by the FBI of two holes in the center divider and two other holes in the southern door jamb. The photographs showed that the holes were circled and labeled by Tew. According to Barber, Tew may have marked the holes, rather than leaving them for the LAPD, on the assumption that the sheriff's office would conduct the primary investigation. There were so few blue suits, LAPD officers, there, that we were really the only police in that area for a period of about 10 to 15 minutes. As the men finished clearing the pantry, LAPD Sergeant Jones recalled seeing what he thought might have been a bullet hole in a door jamb. At the Rampart station, Calkins and McGann interviewed Dick Aubrey, who worked part-time for the Negro Press Bureau. Aubrey had been walking in front of Kennedy through the pantry. Aubrey saw a short, Caucasian male in a dark sports coat, about 25 to 26 years old, kneeling on the table, getting down as he passed him. Aubrey had just reached the end of the first steam table when he heard something. He heard one shot, then five more in a spurt. I thought it was Chinese firecrackers. It was just a constant pow-pow, just cracking, like a little bag of potato chips or something. He saw a flash, like a little spark. "Did you see this guy with the flashes coming out of his hand?" "Oh, yes," Aubrey replied. He described how the gunman was 6 or 7 feet in front of Kennedy at the time. "It was just the flashes I saw. I thought I saw somebody throw a firecracker right at him." "Did you get any indication at all that there was anybody helping this assailant who shot the senator?" "Booker Griffin asked me, 'Should we take off after the other cat? Like this?' And my first impulse was to say yes, but..." "But by then it was all over?" "Yes. But Booker said, did they get the other guy?
Calkins and McGann took down the little information Aubrey had on Booker Griffin, the publicity director for the Negro Industrial Economic Union. Despite this provocative information, indicating a possible accomplice, the LAPD would not interview Griffin until late July, and then only after Griffin had provided his own account in a local newspaper. The FBI, however, didn't wait that long. Griffin told the FBI a few days later of a 6'2" Caucasian male he had seen a few times that night in the company of the suspect and currently in custody. Other witnesses would provide similar accounts, which sounded remarkably like the suspect Shiraga had been seeking in his earliest broadcasts. Over police radio, an officer asked if another suspect was still being sought. Control responded by rebroadcasting Shiraga's description of the 6'2" Caucasian male suspect. Shiraga added, code 2 on that, indicating that the information should be given urgent attention. 2 minutes later, Inspector Powers got on the radio and asked Shiraga, where did you get your information on this second suspect wanted on the broadcast? The second suspect came from a witness who was pushed over by this suspect, Shiraga replied. Witness and his wife. We have name and address. The juvenile officers who were collecting witnesses initially have a sheet of paper with the name and address of this witness. What proximity to the shooting were these people? Powers asked. They were adjacent to the room. Disregard that broadcast, Powers said. We got Rayford Johnson and Jesse Unruh, who were right next to him, and they only have one man and don't want them to get anything started on a big conspiracy. This could be somebody that was getting out of the way so they wouldn't get shot. But the people that were right next to Kennedy say there was just one man. Either Powers had been misinformed or he was deliberately misrepresenting, as neither man had said that. And Rafer had twice noted that, due to his focus on the man with the gun, he didn't look around to see whether others were involved. But Shiraga had no way of knowing that, and dutifully followed Powers' orders. 2L30 to control. Disregard my broadcast. A description, male Caucasian, 20 to 22, 6 foot to 6'2". This is apparently not a correct description. Disregard and cancel. Ironically, at nearly the same time that Shiraga's description was canceled, two juvenile officers, perhaps the ones to which Shiraga had just given the name and address of two witnesses shortly before, broadcast a description of a male Latin and a female Caucasian wanted as suspects. Despite Powers' best efforts, the door to conspiracy was about to be pushed wide open. Deputy District Attorney John Ambrose was approached by Sandra Serrano as he stood outside the hotel's main entrance. She told him how a young man in a gold sweater and a girl in a polka dot dress had come by her, saying, "We shot him." He took her contact info and walked her down to the gold room. Before Serrano appeared on the television, Vince DiPiero, who had overheard Serrano describe a woman in a polka dot dress, volunteered to Ambrose that he, too, had seen a girl in a polka dot dress in the pantry just as the shooting was starting. Serrano and DiPiero had a brief exchange of not more than a few seconds before an officer interceded and said they should not talk to each other. Nearly immediately, according to Ambrose, NBC's Sander Van Oker pulled Serrano aside and put her on camera. Ambrose asked one of the officers if that was a good idea, letting a witness talk to the press before the police had heard her story. "I guess there's nothing we can do about that now," the officer told Ambrose. On live TV, at about 1:30 a.m. Pacific time, Van Oker asked Serrano to recount what she had seen and heard. The distraught Serrano told the pre-dawn national audience, Serrano, "Well, he, everybody was in the main room, you know, listening to him speak, and it was too hot, so I went outside, and I was out on the terrace, and I was out for about
5-10 minutes, you know. I started to get cold. And then, you know, and everybody was cheering and everything. And then I was standing there just thinking, you know, thinking about how many people there were and how wonderful it was. Then this girl came running down the stairs in the back, came running down the stairs and said, "We've shot him. We've shot him." "Who did you shoot?" And she said, "We've shot Senator Kennedy." And I can remember what she had on and everything. And after that, a boy came down with her. He was about 23 years old, and he was Mexican-American, because I can remember that, because I'm Mexican-American. And I says, "What's happening?" And all of a sudden, all these people start coming down that back end. And I walked in, and I was by the bar area, and nobody seemed to know anything about it. And I thought, well, you know, maybe I misunderstood or something.
Van Oker, wait a minute. Did this young lady say, "We"?
Serrano, "We," she said.
Van Oker, meaning, "We the Mexican-Americans"?
Serrano, no, she was not of Mexican-American descent. She was not. She was Caucasian. She had on a white dress with polka dots. She was light-skinned, dark hair. She had black shoes, and she had a funny nose. I thought it was really funny. All my friends tell me I'm so observant.
When she finished, the police wanted to question Serrano at Rampart Station. Serrano asked Ambrose to come with her. She also asked him to call her aunt and uncle to tell them she was all right. Ambrose made the call and then drove to Rampart to join Serrano. But when he arrived, the police told him he was not needed. Back at Parker Center, in room 318, the suspect faced John Howard of the Los Angeles County District Attorney's Office, Jordan, Sergeant A.B. Melendrez, another detective from Rampart, and George Murphy from the DA's office. Like the others before him, Howard informed the suspect of his rights. "Do you understand your rights, first of all?"
"Yes, I think that I shall remain incognito," the suspect replied.
Howard gave the suspect his number and asked him to call any time, day or night, if he wanted to reach him. Howard explained what was ahead for the suspect. "You will be booked. That's a legal procedure. Fingerprints, pictures taken, everything like that. After that time, I'm sure you will be able to clean up." Oddly, the suspect seemed not to care about any of that. He wanted to talk about something else. "How long have you been with the DA's office, Mr. Murphy?" the subject asked. "Remember Kirschke?" A year earlier, Los Angeles Deputy District Attorney Jack Kirschke had been found guilty of 2 counts of murder for killing his wife and her lover, a charge Kirschke had vigorously denied. Howard wondered why the suspect was so interested in the Kirschke case. He told the suspect they'd take up the subject again and ended the conversation. At the Ambassador Hotel, the LAPD criminalist who had presented key evidence at Kirschke's trial, Officer Dwayne Wolfer, reported to Sergeant James MacArthur in the pantry. Wolfer had called in LAPD photographer Charles Collier and Sergeant William Lee to help him. Collier was assigned to photograph, among other items, bullet holes. For the next few hours, Wolfer and his team, on behalf of the LAPD's Special Investigation Division, SID, scoured the scene of the crime, collecting what evidence they could, and photographing anything of significance. Outside the Ambassador Hotel, Deputy H.J. Foster, who had been patrolling the patio area east of the Palm Court, saw a man step out of the bushes. Foster asked him what he was doing there. The 24-year-old Terry Lee Fraser became nervous and evasive and denied walking in the bushes. Foster apprehended Fraser and took him to the sheriff's command post at the IBM building for questioning, where he released him to Sergeant D.J. Fossey's custody,
who contacted Shiraga by radio. Sergeant Davis of the sheriff's office wanted an LAPD unit to meet him at the IBM unit to interview this suspect. Shiraga responded that there'd be about a 5-minute delay getting officers to the building. Shiraga then tried to notify Lieutenant Sillings that a sheriff's unit at the IBM building had some people to be interviewed and asked if they should be brought back to the command post. But immediately after Shiraga mentioned sending officers to the IBM building, Shiraga's command post communications went out for the next 21 minutes. Someone had left a microphone on that interfered with the command post's channel. Officer A.D. Bollinger and LASO deputies Wernicke and Foster brought Fraser to the command post. After Shiraga's communications were restored, Shiraga asked Shillings over the radio, "What they believe is a suspect. Do you want him in there, or do you want him taken to Rampart?" "Take him to Rampart," Sillings responded. Fraser, the third known suspect apprehended that night, was taken to the Rampart station, where he was fingerprinted, photographed, interviewed, and held until 6 a.m. Back at Rampart Station, McGann and Calkins interviewed Thane Caesar, the security guard who had been at Kennedy's right elbow when the shooting started. Caesar told them he worked days at Lockheed, but also did assignments for Ace Security. He gave them his manager, Tom Spangler's, home number, as Spangler was the one who had asked him to come to the Ambassador Hotel that night. Today, people's home number and work number are often the same, a cell phone number. But in the 1960s, people had different landline numbers for their workplace and home. It was odd, then, that Caesar had Spangler's home number at the ready, but not his office number. Caesar described that when Kennedy had entered the pantry after his speech, Caesar had grabbed Kennedy's right elbow with his left hand and stayed with him. As they had reached the first steam table, Kennedy turned to his left. "When he did, my hand broke loose, sort of broke loose from his arm, and of course I grabbed it again, because people were still all over the place. I just happened to look up, and that's when I seen, all I could see was an arm and a gun, and I reached for mine, but it was too late. He had done fired, and when he did, I ducked, because I was as close as Kennedy was, and from what I can remember, from what I did, I grabbed for the senator and fell back, and when I hit, there's ice boxes right here, and I fell against that, and then the senator fell right down in front of me." According to Caesar, the gunman was standing behind the camera crews, and all I could see was his hand and the gun. Caesar didn't think it sounded like a 38, and guessed the gun was a 22. Caesar didn't recognize the gun, saying he'd seen only the end of the barrel. He suspected the gunman was short because he hadn't seen his face, only an arm sticking out from the crowd. At 2:15 a.m., the primary suspect was booked at the central jail, charged with 217 PC, assault with intent to commit murder. In the nearby police headquarters, Jordan, Howard, and Murphy sat down with Jesse Unruh. "I must have been 20 to 30 feet behind him," Unruh said as he entered the pantry. "I heard this crackle of what I thought was really firecrackers, and I don't really quite remember how many reports there were. I'd guess, it sounded to me like somewhere between 5 and 10, but there was such a sharp crackle that I couldn't distinguish the individual reports." He hadn't seen the actual shooting. At Rampart Station, Calkins and McGann continued to interview witnesses. Esteline Duffy had been with her friend Joseph LaHive, whom NBC interviewed earlier, in the hallway between the stage and the swinging doors through which Kennedy entered the pantry. Kennedy entered the pantry just ahead of them, after which Duffy heard what she later learned were shots. "They weren't real loud. Sounded like a whip going," she told them. "I thought I heard at least 10 shots. It wasn't one or two. It was a lot of shots." the suspect's gun could only hold 8 bullets. At the sound of the shots, Lahive had rushed into the room and joined the struggle to get the gun from the suspect. He told Calkins and McGann, in my own rash conclusion at the time, this many shots couldn't have come from this little revolver. The police were particularly interested in obtaining any photos from the event. Did the police want the photos so they could do a thorough investigation? Or did the police want to control all photographs, lest something suggesting a conspiracy leak out? High school student Scott Enyart had been standing on a table in the pantry, waiting for Kennedy so he could take his picture, when the shooting began. He took pictures while the shots were being fired, or maybe a little afterward, he wasn't sure. He jumped up on one of the steam tables, so he had a good view of the room. Enyart mentioned his friend Brent Gold was there with him, taking pictures as well. Enyart wanted to know if he'd get his pictures back, stressing they were very important to him. He was told he might get back prints or negatives, but the police weren't sure which. McGann gave him his card and told Enyart to call back, maybe Thursday or Friday, and they'd let him know the status of his pictures. 40 years later, Enyart would win a lawsuit against the LAPD over this film. But as the film was ostensibly being returned to him, it was stolen from the courier's car. Hotel maitre d' Eddie Manasian told Calkins and McGann he had been standing to the right of Kennedy and slightly in front of him as the shooting began. Kennedy had just finished shaking someone's hand when a man came up and reached around his left. He fired 2 or 3 shots before Manasian and Carl Euchre grabbed him. Euchre had been ahead and to the right of Kennedy by about 4 to 5 feet, according to Manasian. He had been leading him through the pantry, but Kennedy broke away to shake hands. Manasian said Kennedy took a step back to shake hands with personnel when Manasian saw someone reach around past Euchre with a gun. He saw 2 shots fired, and then Euchre grabbed him. Manasian jumped forward to help, but turned to look back. He saw Paul Schrade fall, then Kennedy. He helped Euchre subdue the suspect. Calkins asked which hand the gun was in, and Manasian said the man's right hand. The man was standing to the front left of Kennedy when he fired. It sounded like firecrackers going off. Calkins showed Manasian the gun and asked if that was the one he remembered. It looked similar, Manasian said. Manasian said Rayford Johnson kept asking, "Why did you do it?" And the shooter kept answering, "Let me explain." Manasian pointed Euchre out to Calkins and McGann, as Euchre was sitting just outside the room where they were talking. When Calkins and McGann interviewed Euchre later, Euchre confirmed the shooter was right in front of me, and that both of them were in front of Kennedy. I think he must have covered the gun with something, paper or something, because the first I didn't see no gun. Then I saw something white, either paper or something, and I heard a shot. I didn't even realize at the first shot that it was a gun, but by the second shot, I turned around and saw Kennedy falling down out of my hand, and then, at the time that I realized it must have been a gun, then I grabbed him. McGann asked, "Did he sort of reach around you to shoot the senator?" Information he had just heard from Manasian. "Yes, I think he was right in front of me, because the way he was right in front of me, right in front. He turned around and shot with his right hand." McGann showed him the gun and asked if the gun appears to be similar to the one you saw. "I tell you the truth, I don't think it was that big. But could be. I really don't." "You're not sure?" "No, I'm not sure, because I didn't pay too much attention to the gun." Both Manasian and Euchre described the man's suit as a work suit that was dark and blue. I thought it was one of our banquet workers, because he had a blue suit on, a dark suit on, Euchre explained. I thought it was one of the busboys, one of the housemen.
The suspect the police had been interviewing had been apprehended wearing a light blue velour shirt that zipped at the neck over a light shirt with light blue denim pants.
Jesus Perez had seen the suspect in the pantry for about a half hour before Kennedy had walked through there en route to the stage. The suspect had asked several times whether Kennedy would be coming through there, but Perez couldn't answer because he didn't know. Perez said the gun he had seen was quite large. When Calkins and McGann showed him the gun and asked if that was the size he remembered, Perez said, "No, I think it's bigger than that." He indicated with his hands how big the gun had looked.
"You thought it was about a foot long?
A foot?"
"Yeah."
Perez described the suspect as a bit taller than himself. Perez was only 5'2". When the police asked Perez if he'd recognize him if he saw him again, Perez said, "I don't want to get involved because, you know, I don't have no protection in the street. You get me in the street, they're going to..."
Unintelligible. "Me."
Apparently, Perez feared retribution from some unidentified conspirator. Elsewhere at Rampart, Sergeant Jack Chiquet and Sergeant Henderson of the Homicide Division interviewed Sandra Serrano about the girl in the polka dot dress. Serrano described how she had been standing on the fire escape stairs outside the southwest exit from the embassy ballroom when a girl in a white dress, a Caucasian, dark brown hair, about 5'6", medium height, with black polka dots on her dress, walked up the stairs past her. With the girl was a young man, about 23 years old, who had on a white shirt, a gold sweater, and he was of Mexican-American descent. A third man had on rather messed-up clothes and a lot of hair. He looked like he needed a haircut or something, and to me he looked like somebody who, you know, just never looks right. She described the third man as Mexican-American, between 5'2" and 5'5" tall. Serrano described how, about 15 to 20 minutes later, the girl and the male in the gold sweater came running back out, with the girl saying, "We shot Kennedy." Serrano described calling her parents and how she didn't know if Kennedy had really been shot until she heard people in the hallway outside her phone booth confirm that Kennedy had been shot and was in critical condition. She ended the call with her mother abruptly to find out about Kennedy's condition. Henderson asked if she had heard gunfire. "Yes," she said, adding immediately, "I didn't know it was a gun. I thought it was the backfire of a car." Henderson asked for more details on the girl. Serrano said the girl had a funny nose, turned up like a pixie nose. She appeared to be 23 to 26 years old, 5'6" tall, 122 to 127 pounds, with short hair and brown eyes. She didn't seem to be wearing a lot of makeup. Serrano was very specific about the dress. It was a white voile dress with black polka dots on it and a bib collar. Henderson asked for more details on the man in the gold sweater. Serrano remembered his hair was greasy, long on top, and combed straight. It was very straight. The sweater was a cardigan. He was wearing dark pants. His height was about 5'5 or 5'6, and she guessed his weight to be around 160 pounds. After her interview concluded, an all-points bulletin, APB, was issued to all agencies requesting information on a female Caucasian, 23 to 27, 5'6", wearing a white voile dress with small black polka dots, three-quarter sleeves, and wearing heels, and a male Mexican-American, 23, wearing a gold sweater. As word of this female suspect spread, the LAPD and FBI began asking all witnesses if they had seen a girl in a polka dot dress. As Robert Houghton, the LAPD chief of detectives, would later note, this information made the suspect's silence even more disturbing. The first 4 hours are the most crucial in any homicide investigation. If the guilty are not apprehended or identified by then, they may never be found. It has proven true in case after case. Captain Brown knew very well that the polka dot girl and her boyfriend could be north of Santa Barbara by now, or heading toward the Arizona line, or within the time factor, already across the Mexican border. The All Points Bulletin would reach agencies in every direction, covering California and parts of Arizona and Nevada. Brown's and Houghton's professed concerns didn't manifest, however, in what followed. Within a few hours, the APB regarding the girl in the polka dot dress and the male in the gold sweater had been altered. The reference to a young man in a gold sweater disappeared. The APB for the girl in the polka dot dress, however, would remain in effect for 2 more weeks. At 3 a.m., Howard rushed back to Central Jail. The suspect had asked to talk to him. Howard was hoping the suspect was ready to reveal his identity. The suspect, however, simply wanted to talk more about the Kirschke case. The suspect was interested not in the specifics, but in the philosophical issue of how the man had found himself at the end of the same law he had used to convict others. He discussed this question with Howard and Jordan. When you are the prosecutor and you want the other man's life, you're thirsty, you're hungering for his blood, and yet you are thrown in his position, how would you want the man that's prosecuting you to react?
Oh, I don't know.
Let me ask you this. How much do you think? I asked the first question, the suspect replied, seizing control of the conversation. You answer first. Jordan said people expect fairness and justice. The suspect went on to ask another extraordinary question. Supposing a defendant was in fact innocent of an accusation of whatever you call it, and Jack Kirschke demanded his life as restitution for his crime, or the wrong he did, would you consider that a request for his life would in some way recompense the innocent lives that he had requested? Jordan and Howard both recognized that something extraordinary was going on here. The suspect, who had ostensibly just killed the second Kennedy with presidential aspirations in 5 years, was calmly discussing the philosophy of justice. Something about all of this prompted Howard to switch gears and ask a very different question of the suspect. You know where we are now? I've told you you've been booked.
I don't know, the suspect responded, justifying Howard's question.
You are in custody. You've been booked. You understand what I've been... The suspect interrupted with something unintelligible, followed by, I have been before a magistrate? Have I or have I not?
No, you have not, Howard responded. You will be taken before a magistrate as soon as possible. Probably will be tried. You're downtown Los Angeles, in the Central Jail. This is the main jail for the LA Police Department. You'll be booked into a cell. Do you understand where you are?
As long as you say it, was the suspect's strange response. Howard tried a last time to elicit the man's name.
If I were going to call you something, what would I call you? George or Pete? Or what?
The suspect said to call him John Doe, having learned of that generic name from one of his LAPD guardians. The suspect asked about Howard's daughter and if she would attend Vassar. Howard, however, was only interested in getting on with the case and left, saying he was going to go back to sleep because I am inherently lazy.
Inherently, the suspect echoed, teasing, you shouldn't be a DA's assistant.
The suspect asked Howard if he ever played the stock market.
Tell me about it. You seem to be wealthy enough to want to speculate in it.
I don't know anything about it, Howard responded.
Really? The suspect asked.
Gee, I mean in legal cases. How? I mean, doesn't the stock or the finances come in at all?
There are much darker things than that that come in, Howard said cryptically. You'd be surprised.
Howard prepared to leave, making certain that the suspect had his number, but also making clear he didn't want to come back for no reason.
As I told you, I'm that lazy.
Inherently, the suspect remembered.
Inherently, Howard reiterated.
Really? How would you, say, judge a man who is inherently lazy, and yet so thriving and wanting to be on the job to impress his superiors? And yet, this guy claims and professes to be inherently lazy.
He should go out and exercise. You've got a lot of it here, the suspect said, apparently referring to Howard's rotund gut. He knows how to hurt a guy, Jordan said to Howard.
At Good Samaritan, Dr. Cuneo and others began a surgical attempt to clean Kennedy's brain of bullet fragments and to restore what mental and physical functions they could. The surgery would last just over 3 hours. Outside the hospital, a growing contingent of supporters prayed that the senator would live. At Rampart, Sergeants Chiquet and Henderson interviewed Los Angeles Rams tackle Roosevelt Rosie Greer, who had been functioning as an unofficial bodyguard for Kennedy.
When I located him, he wasn't firing.
Greer saw a gun was beside the suspect on the steam table.
I don't know if it was another weapon or the same one, Greer said,
raising an interesting issue that neither Chiquet nor Henderson showed any interest in pursuing.
Chiquet was preoccupied with another question.
Did you at any time see a female near him wearing, also of Latin extraction, wearing a polka dot dress?
No, I didn't see her.
Like Rafer Johnson, Greer hadn't been looking around. Greer had been focused on keeping the suspect from killing anyone and keeping anyone from killing the suspect.
Officer Frank Foster tried his hand with the suspect, whose life Rosie may well have saved. The suspect had turned to a new topic, the Boston Strangler, the nickname given to a man who confessed to strangling several women to death between 1962 and 1964, and the title of Gerald Frank's 1967 book about the case.
Well, I'm only topically familiar with that, with the whole story about him, not with the individual himself.
So how does it go? The suspect asked.
Have they found out his name? I mean, the guy who done this.
Foster told him the man's last name was DeSalvo.
It's odd that the suspect seemed not to know the name of the guy who did it, since DeSalvo, ostensibly a phonetic version of DeSalvo, was written in an odd, repeated manner on a page in a notebook belonging to the suspect that the police would soon confiscate.
McGann and Calkins interviewed Martin Petruski, a hotel waiter who had been in the pantry when Kennedy came through. He shook Kennedy's hand and saw him shake the hands of his friend and fellow waiter, Vincent DiPiero, a girl in a white dress, Robin Kasdan, a busboy, Juan Romero. And then, all of a sudden, there was just a matter of maybe 4 or 5 feet from us. I heard, like, somebody throwing firecrackers. And all that I seen was this guy standing from... There's a tray rack on the opposite side of the steam table, and all I seen was the guy moved over. And he looked... There was, like, 2 people in front, and the guy looked like he was smiling. And he looked like he was going to shake hands with him, and he reached over like this. And then the firing just started. And the next thing I know, I looked at Vincent, and I seen Kennedy starting to go down on his knees. And I looked at Vincent, and his glasses all of a sudden come up with blood. Petruski thought the suspect's pants were black with blue checks in them. DiPiero would describe the pants as light blue with black checks in them. The suspect in custody was wearing blue jeans. I think he had a blue jacket, but when I seen him later, when they were pulling him away, all I saw was the white shirt. He thought the shooter was 28 to 30 years old, Mexican or Puerto Rican or Cuban, and a little taller than himself.
Petruski was 5'4". The suspect in custody was 5'4½", but only 24 years old. As the morning ticked by, the witness accounts continued to paint a strange picture. Sergeants Chiquet and Henderson interviewed Freddie Plimpton, wife of George Plimpton, a famous writer and Kennedy supporter, who had become the first editor-in-chief of the Paris Review, a European literary magazine that the CIA had funded in the hopes of persuading the continent to support the American establishment's point of view on foreign affairs. Freddie described hearing what sounded like yesterday in Chinatown, referring to the firecrackers that scared the Kennedy group in Chinatown in San Francisco 2 days earlier. She described how she was ahead and to the right of Kennedy, saw him shake a busboy's hand, and saw someone push in close and fire a gun, who was then pushed down on the steam table nearby. She thought the suspect might have been Filipino, and in his early 30s, she thought he had been wearing white, like so many of the kitchen staff. But she was told by others the shooter had not been in white, and she was just very confused about that right now. She had not actually seen the shooting, but from his position and his posture, she'd just assumed that he was the guy that fired. McGann and Calkins interviewed Michael Lawrence Wayne, the man caught running from the pantry with a rolled-up poster in his hand that some witnesses thought concealed a gun. Wayne described how Kennedy had signed a poster for him when Kennedy had passed through the pantry to get to the stage to give his speech. He was still in the pantry when Kennedy came back through after his speech. "And I heard a sound, I guess like backfires. I wasn't quite aware of it until I heard some more of them, and there was a commotion. He's been shot. He's been shot. And I saw the... I believe he was wearing... I can recognize if I saw it. He was wearing, like, a blue jacket." Wayne described how a group descended on the suspect and pushed him onto the steam table. "I was in shock for a minute, and then I ran into the press room, which was the colonial room, and I tried to call an operator, to call the police, what have you, and all the phones had the lights on. You cannot call out. So I ran outside the colonial room, this way, to go ask what happened, you know? So I can't talk about it, so I don't, you know... In other words, not out of fear, but I just thought it would be best, rather than that, to cause panic. So I ran out towards, I believe there's another room on this side that was not the main room. And then there was a waiter there, and I asked him, 'Where's the telephone?' And he pointed it out. So then I ran out, and there was a security guard. And I asked him, 'Can you get me to the telephone? Can you get me to the telephone?' And he cuffed me, thinking I may have been the suspect. And I was detained by security for about an hour and a half." McGann asked if he was with Scott. He couldn't remember the last name and thought it might have been Egert. He was referring to Scott Enyart, who had taken pictures in the pantry. Wayne remembered speaking to Scott, but didn't know him. McGann asked Wayne if he had taken any pictures. "No, I didn't. I didn't have my camera tonight." "No pictures, huh?" McGann queried again. "No, sir." "Huh. He seemed to think you took some pictures down there." "No, it was the other guy that did." "Who was that?" "That was another guy downstairs. Downstairs right now." "That took some pictures, huh?" "Yes. I believe they have his roll of film out here." "Other than this Scott?" "I don't know his name, like I said. There was at least one person that took photographs." McGann returned to the main subject. "Can you identify this suspect again?" "Yes." "What kind of gun would you say it was?" Wayne said maybe it was a .22. He knew it was a handgun of some sort. "A small gun or a large gun? In other words, a long barrel or a short barrel?" "I think it was a short barrel. I remember about 3 years, more than that, about 5 years ago, I went with a friend to the Las Vegas police rifle range, and I did some. I shot a few shots with a .38,
I remember the sound was rather loud.
Uh-huh.
And when I was in the Boy Scouts, they had a 45 exhibition once, and it was fantastically loud.
Uh-huh.
Yet these shots were not really loud. I was right on top of it, but they didn't sound that loud.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.